following program is a special presentation of Fox Sports Net.
The Furman Paladins began this season with the highest of expectations, led by senior quarterback Billy Napier and former star Bobby Lamb in his first season as head coach. Furman was on a roll until this.
It's intercepted! Appalachia can take it back for two and take the lead! They've got a chance to take the lead!
Furman is charged back from the rubble of near disaster, showing what it hopes has been the heart of a champion, in position to win another Southern Conference championship. But Furman has caught the eye of the Eagles of Georgia Southern, who got off to a rocky start with a new quarterback. But this team has defined the heart of a champion with a powerful attack, which is again one of the top offenses in the country. Now, Georgia Southern shoots for an unprecedented sixth straight conference championship. South Carolina, on the campus of Furman University, where Paladin Stadium has a playoff-like atmosphere, as ninth-ranked Georgia Southern visits number four Furman on a day conference title hopes will end for one of these outstanding teams. Hello again, everyone. I'm Paul Crane, and we've got one of the best matchups in all of college football. This is one of those rivalries where the records don't matter, but today they do. Georgia Southern, shocked in its conference opener, has reeled off six straight wins, setting up its conference finale today. Win, and the Eagles are guaranteed of nothing worse than a tie for the conference title. Furman, after that crushing defeat at Appalachian, is again in control of its own destiny. With three conference games remaining, win them all, and the Paladins will win the conference title outright. Joining me again this week is my partner Ethan Horton. And Ethan, if Furman is going to win, it will need a great performance from senior quarterback Billy Napier.
Paul, you're exactly right. When you look at Billy Napier, here's a guy that's a field general. He runs his football team. He is everything a coach wants on a football field. He changes the plays along the line of scrimmage. He puts his team in fantastic situations. Last year at Georgia Southern, playoff game, 12 for 12, 159 yards and a touchdown. He will need that type of consistency to keep that high-powered Georgia Southern offense off the field.
Well, on the Georgia Southern side, the quarterback has a different and in many ways more important role, as everything with that triple option runs through the quarterback position. And sophomore Chaz Williams is in his first year on the job.
He is. When you look at Chaz Williams, here's a guy, you look at the past 6 weeks, phenomenal football. Six consecutive weeks of 100 yards rushing. He understands this offense. He is starting to mature. If there's one thing about Chaz Williams where he has a flaw in his game, it's he drops the ball on the ground. And today is a game where you can't have turnovers. He's going to have to play well. He's going to have to be very efficient, Paul. I think Chaz Williams, he hasn't been in a big game, but hey, it's the first time for everything.
And it happens today. The stage is just about set. We're ready to go. Georgia Southern and Furman have quite a history. They know each other very well and don't like each other at all. Welcome back to Greenville, South Carolina, where the Furman Paladins are taking the field, ready to go against ninth-ranked Georgia Southern. What a Southern Conference matchup we've got. A playoff-like atmosphere as two of the best teams, not only in the Southern Conference, but in all of 1AA football, face each other with much on the line today. Let's welcome in the third member of our broadcast crew, Jim Noble, who who's down on the field with Furman head coach Bobby Lamb.
All right, Bobby, you've been involved in one of these games as a player, 12 as an assistant. As you enter your first as a head coach, explain what it means to everybody when Furman and Georgia Southern tee it up.
Well, it started back in 1985 and I was there as a player. We're only 3.5 hours apart, and so far it's been a great football game. You're always playing for a championship. I think that makes it special, and it'll be a great game today.
You've got about 60 seconds to kick off. What has to go right for you guys early?
We cannot turn the football over, and we've got to play responsibility on defense. We've got to handle their option and get them in third and long.
Coach, congratulations. Thanks so much for joining us. Good luck today. Guys, electric atmosphere down here. As you can hear, the band is playing. What do you say we get this party started?
Jim, I think that's a great idea. You talked about time of possession. The last thing Bobby Lamb wants to see is third and short for these guys. And this rivalry, which began in 1985, Furman has won two of the last three over the last 4 years. As you can see, either Georgia Southern or Furman has played in the national championship game. Now, last year in December, these teams met in the playoffs. Georgia Southern had a 17-7 lead at half before fumbling the second half kickoff. Turnovers would become the second half story as Furman came charging back, dominating the second half. All-world fullback Adrian Peterson was held to a career low, 68 yards, and Furman ended Georgia Southern's 39-game home winning streak and their perfect playoff record at home. Payback, the order of the day today for Georgia Southern.
No, I think so. I think when you look at these two football teams, they know each other very well. This is nothing new for both teams. They're used to playing for conference championships. They're used to being in the playoffs. And right now, you stated, Paul, we have that type of atmosphere, and I expect a very good football game.
Well, we're just about ready to kick things off as Georgia Southern will be kicking to Furman to open the game. Ryan Bratton back to receive for Furman. And the kick from Scott Shelton is on the way. Bratton takes it at his five, looks for some room, and Georgia Southern has it covered like a blanket. Bratton not able to get back even to the 15-yard line. The Buy-Low Supermarket starting lineups. We'll look at the Furman offense, led by senior quarterback Billy Napier, moving up the school's all-time charts. He needs a great game today. He's a Peyton Award finalist. The front line is three seniors: Bryce Kruger and Stephen Kane, who's 6'5", 3'10", and drawing all sorts of attention from NFL scouts. Furman plays three tailbacks. Brigham goes first today. Bear Reinhardt is Napier's go-to guy. Isaac West, a deep threat. First play from scrimmage. Furman at its own 14-yard line. Napier wants to throw, and he's in a world of trouble, and down he goes inside his 5-yard line. Georgia Southern. Freddie Pesceta making his presence known right out of the gate. A look at that Georgia Southern defense, led by the two-time All-American senior Pesceta. Sophomore Eric Hadley has really come on of late. Because of Furman's balanced attack, the linebackers are key, especially senior Joe Scott in the middle. And the secondary is led by strong safety David Young, an All-American who Furman coach Bobby Lamb calls the Eagles' best player. But Furman had talked about wanting to stay on the ground, trying to throw in a world of hurt. They're second and long from their own 7-yard line. Napier out of the shotgun. This time gives it to Brigham. Brigham with some room gets back close to the original line of scrimmage, but Ethan, it will be third and long.
Well, this is a passing situation. Napier, one of the better passers in the Southern Conference. He completes like 68% of his passes, so he's very efficient. I want to go back to Freddie Pesceta. He is starting today. He's not on the inside where he will get double-teamed. He's on the outside, and he's out there freelancing one-on-one. So we've already seen the presence of Freddie Pesceta, but can he become that impact player all afternoon?
And a week ago, he played on the inside, played very well, but of course against this offense, could be more effective on the outside. He swings out to the right side on this play as Napier doesn't like some of the things he sees. Third and long, and again, a passing situation. Napier out of the shotgun, and somebody must have moved. We have a flag. So it's kind of a rocky start here for the Paladins. Already out of their game plan, they really wanted to try to control the clock. They'd like to control time of possession, keeping Georgia Southern's offense off the field.
Well, I think they will. I think anytime you have a penalty starting out, it definitely puts your offense in a bad situation.
Before the snap, delay a game on the offense, 5 yards.
Instead of somebody moving, nobody moved. They didn't get the snap off before the clock, so now it's third and even longer. Again, Furman deep in its own territory at its own 8-yard line, facing a third and 16. Billy Napier, 4 wide receivers, 2 at the top of your screen. Napier again in the shotgun. And looking from his own end zone. Complete to Isaac West, and then he drops it. In his fingertips, never able to hold on, and definitely a rocky start for the Paladins, who will have to punt.
I tell you what, this is going to be a very interesting ball game. We've just started on the first drive. Furman, penalty. It takes him out of their offense. Defensively, you got to say, Georgia Southern, they're feeling pretty good right now because they're going to get very good field position.
Well, Bo Moore in to punt from his own end zone. He's averaging 40 yards per punt, and Anthony Williams awaits in Furman territory, and Williams at the 46 looks for something, still standing, and then a purple team meeting on him at the 45-yard line. We have a flag, but Georgia Southern will be starting with very good field position.
I think that flag's on number 29, Jonathan Wilkerson, maybe holding.
A block in the back on Georgia Southern, so they will get pushed back a little bit, but still good field position. And here's a look at the Georgia Southern offense. Sophomore quarterback Chaz Williams, in his first year at the helm of this triple option, he is rewriting several school standards for the position. The offensive line is key. Senior center Charles Clark not only has a GPA over 3.3, but his now 39 consecutive starts are tops on the offense. The backs and receivers are speed demons and big play players. Redshirt freshman Jermaine Austin has done a great job of stepping into that key fullback position. Slot back Mark Myers could be the fastest of the bunch. So Georgia Southern will start from its own 45-yard line. Good field position, first and 10 for Chaz Williams. And this triple option offense. Zazreem Walden goes in motion, and Williams calls his own numbers across midfield and into Furman territory. Here's the Paladin defense, the front line anchored by 300-pounder LeBryan Sperling. Sophomore Michael Barant getting his second straight start and second of his career. The linebackers will become critical defending the triple option, especially sophomore Mike Killian in the middle, seeing this one for the first time. In the secondary, Rodney Johnson is the best cover man, but today will be about run responsibilities at the right times because the home run ball is always a threat. But second and 3 for Georgia Southern. From the 48-yard line of Furman, and Williams quickly gives it to the fullback Jermaine Austin, met at the line of scrimmage. A good defensive effort from Furman.
A very good defensive effort, and that's where this game is going to be won, in the trenches. I think the offensive guards at Georgia Southern, they're going to have to get some push on that defensive front because that fullback is very important in this offense. See there, not a lot of push by the guards up front. And if that fullback cannot get involved in this football game, there is no triple threat with the option.
Barant, the first man to hit him, and Mike Killian from the middle cleaning up. It's third and short. Big play for both teams. Williams on the keeper, then pitches. That's Z. Walden knocked out of bounds, but he gets the first down inside the 45-yard line of the Paladins.
Well, he picked up the first down, but 25, Rodney Johnson takes the quarterback. Nobody there for the pitch. And that's what this offense does. You have H-backs, slot backs coming across in motion. They're whirly birding. They're doing a lot of things in the backfield. And defensively, you have to play your responsibility and be aware of where the numbers are because sometimes they're to the right or they're to the left.
So Georgia Southern moves the chains for the first time, first and 10 from Furman's 42-yard line. Chaz Williams under center. On the keeper to the right side. Williams has running room inside the 30. Williams down the right sideline, cuts back in, and he stepped out of bounds. But another big play for the Georgia Southern offense.
A very big play. Once again, you come back with Mark Myers. He whirly birds. On the last play, he came across the line of scrimmage. Now he's going back. You see, you got two offensive guys right there as blockers. Williams, he leads this conference in rushing. This is why, because he's able to get up the field and make things happen. And he's the key to this ball game.
Well, he stepped out of bounds just inside the 15-yard line. The spot comes down to the Furman 13, so just like that, Georgia Southern now knocking at the door. First and 10 from the Furman 13-yard line. Williams again under center. This time gives it to the fullback, Austin. Austin hit just on the other side of the line of scrimmage, a pickup of one, maybe two.
Well, Austin, he's that hidden factor in this offense. I realize Williams being number one in rushing in the conference. Austin, he's number two. And the reason why I say he's hidden because he gets lost in there. He's not as big as Adrian Peterson, so he's not the big dominant runner to the inside. But if you can get this kid to the outside or to the off-tackle box, he's going to make something happen.
Jazz Williams again under center. Derek Owens swung wide to the left, but Williams on the keeper, and he is met and kept from any big gain there.
Well, you got to look at LeBryan Sperling, 98. I'm going to talk about this inside play all afternoon because, see there, he doesn't get blocked. He rolls out and he makes a play. Jazz Williams in this part of the field, they like to run that option, but get him back to the inside. If Sperling can take away the inside, they'll have to look elsewhere.
Sperling creating a problem. Eddie Overdyke finishing it off. And third and long for Georgia Southern. See Walden, the man in motion, and he gets the pitch. Walden with the first down. He's inside the five. It'll be first and goal for Georgia Southern. Paul Billingsley on the tackle, saving the touchdown.
See, right now, you look at this offense, they're running a lot of bodies to the right and to the left. Those slot backs, as I've stated before, they've gone across the formation. They've whirly-birded the formation. They've come across on the pitch. And that time, number 93, Brandon Poole, he was kind of stuck between a rock and a hard place. Do I go with the quarterback or do I go with the back? The back won that battle.
Well, Georgia Southern, we've talked about their powerful offense. Inside the 10-yard line this year, they've punched it into the end zone 27 out of 30 times, and they're knocking at the door. First and goal inside the five. Jazz Williams on the keeper, over the goal line. Touchdown, Georgia Southern, and just like that, it's 6-0.
Well, it was a short field. Jazz Williams did what he was supposed to do. He engineered a drive with a short field, putting points on the board. Offensively, they did not make any mistakes, and that's why they're leading right now. You look at Georgia Southern. Defensively, they played a great stand on the first series to give them that. And here you're going to see this kid just take it in for the 6 points, and he has 17 touchdowns on the season. So that should tell you something. When this team gets to the goal line, number 10 is going in for the score.
And Chaz Williams now one shy of the Georgia Southern school record for touchdowns in a season by a quarterback. And the extra point is good. So Georgia Southern behind the triple option offense, run by sophomore Chaz Williams, punches it in on its first possession and grabs the early lead. Southern Conference football on Fox Sports Net is brought to you by your Carolina Ford dealers, driving the Carolinas. By Microtel Inns and Suites, Microtel, get a room. By Pepsi, the joy of Pepsi. And by Bilo Supermarkets, the ultimate place for tailgating essentials. A beautiful day on a beautiful campus at Furman University for what's shaping up to be an outstanding football game. Georgia Southern has grabbed the lead, averaged 10.25 yards per first down play on its first possession. And we're ready to go as Brian Bratton from his own end zone brings it out to about the 15, and the football is loose, and it looks like Georgia Southern may have recovered the football.
No, Furman, they got it back.
All right, Georgia Southern jumping up and down, but prematurely. Furman fortunate that this was not a turnover.
Mr. Special Teams, number 80, Carl Kearney, watch right here. He gets in and makes a play. 14 tackles, make that 15 tackles. Special Teams tackles on the season. Carl Kearney, he understands. He starts as a wide receiver. He doesn't get a lot of action there, so he knows in order for me to be some type of player to make a difference, it must be on special teams.
Furman definitely dodged a bullet there because Georgia Southern had its hands on it. Bratton having led the nation in kickoff returns a year ago. And Furman, nothing doing on the pitch. Lucky to get back to the original line of scrimmage. And again, it's going to be second and long for the Paladins.
Well, you touched on it, Paul. Bratton, here's a guy that's a marked man, an All-American last year. And anytime you go out and make a name for yourself, you know that the next season that follows, those teams are going to be gunning for you. So that's why he hasn't really gotten off to such a great start as he did last year.
Lamar Rembert now in the game at the tailback position. No gain on the play. And Napier again from the shotgun. He looks to throw. And he's got his man, Bear Reinhardt, across the 20. He'll be shy of the first down, a pickup of about 9, but Furman will have a third and short. David Young on the coverage.
Well, you knew that wasn't going to take very long. Bear Reinhardt, Billy Napier, you know, two players that came in together. And these two guys, they work out in the offseason. So they know each other very well. When Napier gets into trouble, he's looking for number 7, Bear Reinhardt.
Best of friends, and as you mentioned, worked throughout the offseason. If ever a quarterback and receiver have been on the same page, it's these two. But Napier, facing a third and short, gives it to Rembert. Rembert straight ahead, met at the line of scrimmage, and we'll have to see where the officials mark the football.
Well, I don't think he made it. Number 70, Eric McIntyre, got into the backfield. Oh, he made it, but very close, because he definitely disrupted the play by pushing his lineman deep into the backfield.
Well, the first down for Furman, it's their first of the game, but they're still just across their own 22-yard line. So a lot of real estate in front of them. Napier up under center, and he's got Bear Reinhardt swung to the right. Isaac West, top of your screen, first and 10 for Furman. Play action, and Napier wants to throw. Looking for West, deep, makes the catch. Inside the 40-yard line, and Furman answers with a big play of its own.
Aaron Whitaker, number 26, he was there to make the play on West, and he couldn't make the play. Isaac West, he has missed some time this season, but now he's back, and he's a deep threat in this offense. He averages over 19.5 yards per catch. You see right there, great concentration. I mean, that ball stayed up there a long time. The wind is blowing, so you know the ball can play some funny tricks on you, but he stays with it, and he comes up with the catch.
He broke his collarbone against Richmond, missed a few games, but he's back, and we're told 100% now. Certainly looks it there. Napier gives it to the fullback, Eric Emerson. Emerson hit at the line of scrimmage. He'll be lucky if he saw the 35-yard line.
But Emerson doesn't carry the ball very much in this offense. I mean, it's a tailback by committee. And they've had a lot of production out of those guys. You lose a guy like Lewis Ivory, you think, oh my goodness, what are we going to do? But all they've done is assemble three tailbacks and one big fullback to get everybody else out of the way, and hopefully he can provide a hole for that running back.
Pickup of 3. It'll be 2nd and 7 from the Georgia Southern 35-yard line. Napier out of the shotgun with Rembert to his right, Emerson to his left, and his buddy Bear Reinhardt in the slot to the right. But he swings it out to Emerson. The fullback makes the catch inside the 35 to perhaps the 33. Derek Butler on the tackle. It'll bring up a 3rd and about 5.
And that's the thing about this offense. Billy Napier can spread the ball around. I mean, they have some very good receivers. We've seen Reinhardt, we've seen Bratton, we've seen West, and now the backs are starting to get involved. And when you defend an offense like this, you have to be aware of your reads, and you have to make sure you know your responsibility before the ball is snapped.
3rd and 5 from the Georgia Southern 33-yard line. Napier again out of the shotgun. A 4 wide receiver set, Isaac West in motion, and Napier looking to throw. Over the middle, overshoots Isaac West. Incomplete. It'll bring up 4th down.
Well, it's a good thing he didn't catch that one, because 51, James Burchett, he had him zeroed in. And I'm not sure Isaac West wanted to come across the middle and catch that one. We saw in the first drive he dropped that one. Punting situation, they come back to him. He tries to use the official as his shield. Now, that part of the route worked. But the second part is Napier must have seen a defender. He must have seen something, because the high throw, but he's got to get that ball down.
Well, they're too far away for a field goal, too close for a punt, so they're going for it on 4th down. This season, Furman a perfect 9-for-9 on 4th down conversions. Their 10th try of the year. Napier out of the shotgun. Wants to throw. Has time. Deep over the middle. It's incomplete. Brian Bratton, the intended receiver, but that one was overthrown.
Well, that's 3. 3 shots in the middle of the field. They've come up empty-handed. And I can't say the ball is sailing on Napier or what, but his passes appear to be just a little high. And maybe the ball is taking off on him, but he's got to get it down. But even if Bratton had caught that one, he was about to get crushed.
Well, Furman now 9-for-10 on the season on 4th down conversions, and Georgia Southern takes over on downs. From its own 33-yard line, Chaz Williams and the Eagles back to business. Williams under center. Again, the triple option, and Williams gives it to the fullback, Jermaine Austin. who gets one, maybe two.
Well, another short field, and you've touched on it. Anytime you've been successful on third and fourth down situations, you have to feel pretty good about it. Fourth and five, Furman does not come up with the first down. Another short field for Georgia Southern. On their first drive, they were able to go down the field and not make any mistakes. But now this is sort of a longer field, and can they do it again?
Pickup of two officially, second and eight. And Furman head coach Bobby Lamb had wanted to be sure that he could get these Eagles in second and long and third and long. But Jermaine Austin busts free, has the first down and much more, running room, and trips at the 35-yard line. Another big play for that triple option.
You're right, but now Austin is involved because of the different looks that the defense that they've seen. Like I said before, they've seen the whirly bird, they've seen the quarterback, they've seen a lot of bodies, but now Jermaine Austin, he pops out of there. And you know, this is what you have to defend. And the reason he's successful is because Chaz Williams has done some good things to the outside. And there at 21, Keto Whetstone, and misses a tackle. And Austin's, you know, he's off for another big game.
And Rodney Johnson, the one who reached as Austin was running past him and made what may have been a touchdown-saving tackle. First and 10 for Georgia Southern at Furman's 33. And hit on the pitch is Mark Myers, a fine defensive effort by Furman.
A very fine defensive effort, Paul. This is something that you have to look at when you play triple option football. It's playing your responsibilities. I mean, everybody has an assignment. See, right now, nobody's on the pitch. But although you can say Paul Billingsley comes off and makes a tackle, he was being blocked. So you got to make sure you know where your guys are, because if you miss your responsibility, it could be the difference in a loss of down or 6 points.
Game of two, second and eight. Jermaine Austin shakes off one tackle, picks up a couple of more yards. He was met at the line of scrimmage, but is able to fight for a couple all on his own.
Well, Cedric Ritter, number 23. I mean, the coaches talked about him yesterday. He leads his team in tackles, 83 hits. Coach Seawalk said, when you look at Cedric Ritter, what he doesn't overcommit. He's going to play his responsibilities, and then he's going to react. That time he did just exactly that.
Third and short. Williams with a pitch to T.J. Anderson. Run out of bounds. Make that Kevin Davis. And it's another first down for Georgia Southern.
Well, this kid has a nice average. One touch last week, 52-yard touchdown. That's pretty good. Get him the football. Let's see what happens. But this is a player that the coaches like. He's very young. And they feel like, hey, we have to start getting some guys involved, because we're going to lose some of our slot backs because they're seniors.
A lot of players involved already. Davis, Anderson's been out there, Walden, and Myers, just from the slot back position. This Jermaine Austin straight ahead. The fullback fights for a couple, and again, Furman calling a team meeting, and that's what they need to do.
Well, they have to surround the football, Paul. Definitely surround that fullback. But as you do that, do not take your eyes off of the quarterback, because Williams is going to stick that ball in the belly, and he's going to pull it out, and he's either going to run the ball himself or he's going to pitch it to one of those fast slot backs. But the fullback is the key here, and I think that's why the coaches of Georgia Southern, that's why they want that push up the middle to give him a chance to run the football.
All right, second and long. Furman doing something about those huge first down plays. Looked like we might have a pass, but what we get is a little shovel pass pitch. Effective as it gains just a couple, but again, Georgia Southern is going to be in third and long. T.J. Anderson, the one taking the little shovel pass.
Well, Eddie Overdyke, 47, stays home. I mean, he got between the back and the quarterback, so no matter what Chaz did on that play, he was able to make a play, and that's why he made the play.
Third and five for Georgia Southern from Furman's 16-yard line. Chaz Williams under center. Kevin Davis in motion. Williams on the keeper. Coughs up the football. We'll wait and see who gets it. And Furman says it did. And the officials do too. So a costly turnover for Georgia Southern. And Furman has the first turnover of the day.
Very costly. It's huge because this is something that he has done constantly. I mean, he makes good plays. He makes bad plays. He had five fumbles last week versus East Tennessee State. And now he comes back. He just doesn't put the ball away. And Whetstone pulls it out 21. And now we're looking at the football going the other way.
This the 32nd time Georgia Southern has coughed up the football, but it's only the 12th time they've lost a fumble. Yes, the ball falls to the ground way too often, but up to this point, they've been able to take care of most of their mistakes.
I would rather not see fumbles. Yes, they are getting them back, but I'm pretty sure when you look at those turnovers, that's something that you don't want to see.
And Mike Seawalk wouldn't want to see it either. Napier on the keeper. Furman running an option of its own. Pretty good pickup, and just like that, the Paladins will be in second and short. David Young coming over to make the tackle.
Well, Bobby Lamb talked about balance, and they've shown that all year. Napier, he's been able to throw the ball very well. They've been able to get some yards on the ground, and now they have their own variation of the option, a little different, but it's something that the defense really hasn't seen because they like to pound that ball that tailback.
Eric Emerson, the fullback for Furman, shaken up on the play. The sophomore from Noonan, Georgia, and while he gets attended to, we'll take a break. Georgia Southern with a first quarter lead. Back in a moment.
Well, Georgia Southern leads Furman 7-0 in the first period. Of course, we've talked about this storied rivalry, but if you want to know where it all began, we take you back to 1985, the first meeting, the national championship game. That's Furman head coach Bobby Lamb. Then a quarterback, 10-yard touchdown run. Furman was up 28-6 when Georgia Southern's Gerald Harris scampered 52 yards, igniting one of the biggest comebacks in college history. It all ended with the catch. 10 seconds. Tracy Hand to Frankie Johnson. 13 yards out. 44-42. Georgia Southern, and one that will go down in the ages in both these schools. Remember all too well.
That they do. Bobby Lamb in particular, Jim. Boy, the hair on the back of his neck still goes up when you start talking about this game. First and 10 for Furman. On the play, Tarico O'Neill getting his first carry of the game, and he got hit hard just across the line of scrimmage.
Or Derek Butler, he comes up and makes the stop number 43. The thing about this Georgia Southern defense is that they're smaller, but they're quick, they're fast, and they're able to react. And, you know, you got to get something in there of misdirection of something like that to give those linebackers, those defensive guys, something to think about.
By the way, Eric Emerson was helped off the field. He's being attended to on the sideline. Corey Tant now in as the fullback. Second and long. Napier wants to throw, and again, overshoots his intended receiver, which was the speedy Isaac West.
Well, I'm trying to figure out what the problem is. I mean, we've seen this guy play. We've talked about him. He's a son of a coach, so you know he understands mechanics. He's been with his head coach, Bobby Lamb, for a number of years as a position coach, and now the head coach, and they trust him. But for some reason, we talked about the big game atmosphere, and it seems like it's affecting Billy Napier and not Chaz Williams.
Napier, second in the nation in passing efficiency, just 3 for his first 7
Darren,
this afternoon.
Darren, I'm going to get your report on Eric Emerson.
3rd and 9. Napier with another passing situation. 4 wide receiver set. West goes in motion, and Napier from the shotgun. In trouble, wants to run across the 30, and is popped. Close to the first down. Oh, my, that's got to make the heart of Bobby Lamb and company skip a beat.
David Young, the All-American number 18, he just brings the heat. He saw that quarterback out there and said, okay, this is my chance. I got a shot. Napier trying to pick up the first down, but he picked up something. And I think he may have gotten the first down, but he also picked up a big lick. He jumps up. Listen to this.
Oh, my. Well, Billy Napier is nothing if he's not tough. Georgia Southern head coach Napier, Mike Seawalk, says that Napier is so tough, he can get back up and then not just throw it through a Coke bottle, but throw it through the straw.
Well,
but so far today, he's had a little trouble with his accuracy.
Well, he has, but those are the type of hits that can lift your football team. And they're short on this particular play because your quarterback, in my book, is normally the guy that can't take a lot of punishment. So when you can find one that's pretty tough, you like those type of quarterbacks, and Napier appears to be that type of quarterback. And see, if his teammates are able to see Billy's fighting, yes, he's struggling, or we're struggling on offense, but we continue to fight, it just carries over to the whole team.
All right, let's go down to the sideline and Jim Noble.
Paul, I can tell you that Eric Emerson, the Furman sophomore fullback, is out for the game. It is a sprained right knee. They got it wrapped in ice, but say he will not return this afternoon.
So that means the position belongs to Corey Tant the rest of the day. It's 4th and less than a yard. And again, Furman going forward on 4th down for the 2nd time today. Quarterback sneak, Billy Napier straight ahead, and it looks like he's got it.
Well, Bobby Lamb, he's playing football, as I like to call it. because he's gone for it twice. And look where he is. His own 35-yard line, his fourth and one, he's going for it. Now, he did put a lot of chips out there, so he must be a gambler because he was able to rake them all in because his team did pick up that first down. But what if they hadn't picked up the first down? Now you turn the ball over to Georgia Southern on a very short field with a very good offense.
But he never hesitated. First down achieved. Furman at its own 36-yard line. First and 10, trailing 7-0. Napier, play action, wants to throw again, looking for Isaac. West overthrows him on the home run ball.
Well, they must like West versus Whitaker because they've gone deep twice. They've hit one, they've missed one. The same type of pass that he caught earlier, with the exception of the ball drifted out of bounds and he wasn't able to really adjust to get it.
We would like to welcome our viewers who have been watching the Big 12 football game between Colorado and Missouri, won by Colorado 42-35. Welcome to our coverage of Division 1AA football. Today, it's a Southern Conference matchup between the ninth-ranked Georgia Southern Eagles and the fourth-ranked Furman Paladins. We are live from Paladin Stadium in Greenville, South Carolina. Along with Ethan Horton and Jim Noble, this is Paul Crane, where the score is Georgia Southern 7, Furman nothing at the closing moments of the first quarter. Georgia Southern's triple option effective on its first possession.
Well, very effective. I mean, down the field for points. You look at Furman's football team offensively, they just seem like they're either out of sync or Georgia Southern, they're better prepared.
Well, Furman will have the opportunity to get itself together. They've got the football and trail by 7. The end of the first quarter. We head to the second with Furman down 7-0, but moving.
Nothing. Georgia Southern over Furman here in Greenville, South Carolina. Welcome back, everybody. If you want to know where it all began for Bobby Lamb, who has spent the major portion of his adult life here at Furman University, well, he was a high school star in Commerce, Georgia, then came here to Furman as a quarterback, a two-year starter for the Paladins. His second year, 1985, maybe the best season a Paladin quarterback has ever had. 24 touchdowns, more than 2,200 yards. Bobby led the nation in passing efficiency. SoCon Player of the Year led Furman to a big upset of NC State. Of course, Lamb was 10 seconds away from a national championship that season until Georgia Southern crushed that dream in the now legendary championship game in Tacoma, Washington. Guys?
Well, Jim, and Bobby Lamb remembers that like it was yesterday, it seems.
Well, he may remember the NC State victory, but we've done what? This is our second game, and he lets me know that Furman also beat North Carolina every chance he gets.
Yes, he does. Third and 9, Furman, from its own 37-yard line, facing a big third-down conversion opportunity. Billy Napier out of the shotgun. Two wide receivers top of your screen. Napier runs out of the pocket and then hits Brian Bratton. Bratton in Georgia Southern territory, inside the 40, taken down at the 38. First down, Furman.
But also he picked up a big block from Bear Reinhart. And Aaron Whitaker, he's still adjusting his helmet, trying to figure out where that number 7 come from.
But it looks like it's coming back, a flag on the play.
Let's cross the line of scrimmage.
Napier running out of trouble, but perhaps running a bit too far.
Well, it's a play where he had to create. And you see he has creativity in his game plan. I mean, nothing's there. He starts to run. And really, it breaks down in front of him. I thought he made a good play, but this is something that he will have to do very close. I mean, make some things happen on his own.
Well, they tried to put on the brakes, not able to stop it.
Quarterback threw the ball after crossing the line of scrimmage. 5 yards.
And he did cross the line of scrimmage.
Lost it down. It's fourth down.
That means Bo Moore is on to punt to the always dangerous Anthony Williams, who averages 11.2. per punt return. He has run one back. Moore averaging 40 yards per kick. And it's up and away. Williams wants the fair catch, and he makes it at the 23, so Georgia Southern will start from there.
Smart play by Williams. I mean, he didn't allow the ball a chance to hit the ground and move toward the end zone, so he makes a running play, smart play.
A great punt as well, 49 yards off the foot of Bo Moore. So Georgia Southern will start from its own 23. And on its first possession, when it drove the length of the field for a touchdown, the Eagles averaged over 10 yards per first down play. That's the kind of thing the Paladins do not want to see. Chaz Williams, with Mark Myers in motion, again gives it to the first man through, the fullback, the redshirt freshman, Jermaine Austin.
Well, Chaz Williams, he has loosened up the defense. We've already seen him run a long gainer. We've already seen the other backs get involved. And now they're coming back to the fullback because those guys on the inside, they have to get to the outside when he decides to go down the line and pitch the football. So now they have to come back and concentrate on number six, Jermaine Austin, because now he's starting to work them in the middle.
Pick up a five on the play, second and five, and again it's Austin. And Austin busts through across midfield and still fighting off several tackles. He's down to about the 46-yard line, but that's another big play.
Another big play, but also good blocking at the point of attack. And this is the type of guard play that Coach Mike Seawalk wanted earlier. He talked about we have to get pushed in the middle. See there? Everything is being moved out in the middle of the field, and that's why Austin has a lot of room. But the linebacker here, this is where you have to pay attention to what's going on. See, he gets blocked. He's out of the play. He can't recover. Austin's gone by.
Mike Killian losing his legs there. Williams on the keeper. Looking for running room, not finding much. He sees the 40 and a little more, but that's about it before Paul Billingsley helps bring him down.
Well, now they're starting to get into a rhythm. We talked about the maturity of Chaz Williams. He has shown the ability to read the option very well. But also, you can say that he hasn't made a lot of mistakes. Yes, he has fumbled the football, but that was due to a great defensive play. But in terms of his decision-making, so far he's done a very good job.
Williams already approaching the 50-yard mark, 48 yards rushing. We're in the opening moments of the second quarter. Georgia Southern leading Furman 7-0 and driving the football inside Furman territory at about the 39-yard line. And Williams on the keeper. This time pitches to Austin. Austin shakes one tackler, gets the first down, and is down at about the 30-yard line.
Well, I thought Whetstone was going to make that play because he was right there. But the ball just got right by him. And then Killian, he is also over there, the middle linebacker. And Killian, you see, Killian, he hasn't really seen this an awful lot. I mean, he's a first-year starting linebacker. See, everybody's trying to get to the outside. Nobody there for the pitch. And so, you see, he gets blocked again, 44. He falls off and makes the tackle. But he's seeing this for the first time. I think that's why he's struggling.
He's also a first-year linebacker, played defensive end a year ago. Jermaine Austin again, and he runs into a lot of bodies at the line of scrimmage. A pickup of two, maybe three, but it'll be second and long.
Well, the same two guys, Whetstone and Killian, they must like something on that side because they continue to work the offense's left side and the defense's right side. So you got two guys that really haven't played an awful lot. Whetstone, he's starting for the first time. Austin, 85 yards, so he's off to a great start. So you're working with two young linebackers, and that's what you should do, attack the weaknesses.
Second and eight, Georgia Southern inside Furman's 30-yard line. Z. Walden in motion. Chaz Williams off the option, tries to cut back inside, but nothing doing.
Well, 93, Brandon Poole. That time he played the option. He played down the line of scrimmage. He watched the quarterback. He made sure responsibility first, quarterback second. But 93 makes the play because he jumps to the outside. See right there? When he jumps out, quarterback comes back in. And that's a good play because he turned him right back to 23, Cedric Ritter.
And Ritter able to finish him off. So third and six for Georgia Southern. This a big play for both of these teams. See Walden in motion again. Williams pitches it to Walden. Around the outside, first down and much more. Inside the 10, Z. Walden inside the 5 before he's pushed out of bounds. First down and first and goal.
But what's happening is this. Furman is getting caught with two defenders on the quarterback, and nobody is taking the back. It's the same two guys. So you got to say Mitch Ware, Mike Seawalk, very good coaching, very good play calling because they are attacking the two young guys that really haven't seen a lot of this offense. Watch 21 in the screen here. So you got two guys back-to-back, 21-98. Somebody's got to get the pitch, and I think it's 21.
assignment football. We've talked about it many times. Sometimes you got to cover a ghost, but sometimes the ghost gets the football, and if nobody's home, it's a big play. Chaz Williams, though, covered on that play, and he gets a whole lot of nothing.
Well, Mike Killian comes through 44. He makes the play. And it's exactly what you said, Paul. It's responsibility football. On defense, normally you're taught react, go to the ball. In this situation, you can't do that. You have to say my responsibility is either this lane where the fullback, the quarterback, or the pitchback, someone is going to come my way. I must do that first, take care of the responsibility, and then react. But right now, Furman, those defenders, they're reacting opposed to taking care of the responsibilities.
Sometimes going to the football leaves a big hole for somebody else. Second and goal for Georgia Southern. Chaz Williams gives it to Jermaine Austin, who pushes his way to the end zone. Touchdown, Georgia Southern.
Credit that to the offensive lineman. What push? I mean, the Furman front, their entire front, I thought it was a no touchdown. They call it down.
Oh,
this line surge is outstanding. I mean, look at the white jerseys. Look at the blue jerseys. They're all in the end zone. How could that not have been a touchdown? But I guess they said his knee was down.
All those white jerseys falling into the end zone, but Jermaine Austin and the football were not among them. So it's third and goal. Inches away from the goal line. Chaz Williams over the top. Now it's a touchdown, Georgia Southern.
Well, Georgia Southern has done exactly what they wanted to do coming into this football game. Stay away from mistakes. Rush the football. Try to stay in short situations when you look at third down and possibly third down and fourth down situations. Stay in those short situations. And that's why they're leading. Furman, on the other hand, they wanted to control the clock, control the ball. They have done neither.
Scott Shelton on to try the point after. He's made 39 of 40 so far this season. And adds another here. So Georgia Southern has jumped on top 14-0, and all of a sudden Furman finds itself in a hole. Chaz Williams making it 14-0 Georgia Southern midway through the second quarter. Welcome back to Greenville, South Carolina, where Georgia Southern has jumped on top of Furman now 14-0. It's back and better than ever. The undisputed champion of pregame shows returns as JB, Terry, Howie, and Jimmy kick off week number 10 of NFL action. This week, we talk to members of the Steelers defense on how they plan on stopping Michael Vick and the Falcons. Fox NFL Sunday returns this week only on Fox, followed by the Steelers battling the Falcons. And Chaz Williams, the sophomore quarterback in his first year at the helm of Georgia Southern's triple option offense, has just tied Tracy Ham's school record for rushing touchdowns by a quarterback set in 1986. Chaz Williams, now his 18th touchdown on the season. And Ethan, for a young man who got off to a rocky start running this offense, he has really come on strong.
Well, he just needed some reps. And I also feel like with the backs and quarterbacks living together, it helped those guys build a bond. They watched tape together. And I think that was was the reason they was able to learn together, because they spent so much time together away from the field.
All of a sudden, Furman, which had wanted to be able to run the football and try to control the clock, finds itself facing a 14-point deficit. Midway through the second quarter, and Bratton fumbles the kickoff. And a loose football. It looks like Georgia Southern has it, and the Eagles do. They'll be starting talk about a short field at the 20-yard line.
You can't give this football team this type of field position. And Bobby Lamb touched on his keys to winning this football game, and so far his football team has not played up to par. Control the football, be good in the red zone, turnovers, and last but not least, execution. And right now his team is not executing. And if they don't turn this around very quickly, they're going home with a big goose egg.
And Brian Bratton led the nation in kick returns a year ago. He's been a marked man this year, but he just coughed it up there. Carl Kearney, the man who recovered the football at Georgia Southern. First and 10, deep inside Furman's territory, is a chance to put up a big lead. Williams on the keeper, picks up about 5, and let's go down to Jim Noble.
Guys, in the brief 60 seconds that Furman's defense was on the bench, defensive line coach Alan Edwards pulled them together and said, guys, you are simply not getting off blocks. There's no scheme. There's no surprises here. You have got to get off these blocks. I know it's not easy, but we don't win the game unless you can.
Well, we've seen how Mike Kelly and Jim has had his legs taken out from under him. Those offensive linemen, if they're able to get into the second level, the linebacker level, they can run all day long.
With Georgia Southern's line, they've done a fantastic job. Look at the yards, 189 to 76, so that speaks right there. But I like the way they're staying low. They're coming off the ball. But, Paul, when you don't pass the ball, you feel pretty good as a lineman because we know coming in, I'm pretty sure they're thinking, we know we are going to have to run the football. We got to run the option to win this game. So there are no surprises to them. We've already known that Bob Lamb said it defensively, keep it simple. So Furman is not going to move around. They said they were going to stunt, and maybe they will because they're getting killed up the middle. But for the most part, what you see is what you get.
Well, Cedric Ritter fighting off a block there, making a big play on Jermaine Austin and forcing Georgia Southern into a third and five situation. Williams on the keeper, inside the 15, brought down shy of the first down. A nice defensive effort from free safety Cam Newton coming over to make the tackle, and now it's a fourth down situation.
Well, I think they'll go for it, but also Cam Newton, he's just pursuing. Now look at all the white jerseys. Now look at the blue jerseys. But he still makes yards, and it goes back to what I said before. If Furman is going to just come out and line up in their base defense and not move around, you don't have to make the offensive line guess. You don't have to make the quarterback guess, something they thought they were going to do with Chaz Williams. Try to confuse him, give him something to think about. But when they come out in their base set ball and they don't move, you make it easy for him.
Well, the momentum has been all Georgia Southern's in this game. Fourth and two, facing the Eagles, and Chaz Williams wants to talk things over. He calls a timeout. I was going to say, Ethan, that pendulum of momentum has clearly been on the Georgia Southern side, but this is one of those plays where Furman could perhaps release it and pull it its way.
Well, they can, but I tell you what, number 10 is probably going to carry this football, and if he doesn't, six will. So, I mean, that eliminates a whole lot of thinking. You got to protect Chaz Williams, and you got to also look at Jermaine Austin, because I don't think anyone else is going to carry the football. They may come back with the option, something they've done. They've been very successful with it. Z. Walden, he's had a big game. Mark Myers, he's come back with something to the backside, and both coaches here, so they're talking about it. I'm pretty sure Bobby Lamb, he's trying to figure out what in the world is going on. I mean, there's a lot of implications with this football game. The playoffs, the conference, Mike Seawalk, he's right where he wants to be, on the road with a big lead. And really, they really have a chance to put seven more points on the board.
Well, we've talked about the conference title being at stake for both of these teams. And a look at the top 10 in Division I-AA. Remember, 16 teams are able to make the playoffs. Furman currently ranked number 4 in the nation, Georgia Southern number 9. But the Southern Conference has 4 teams ranked in the top 15. Appalachian State, 14. Wofford, 15. But it's hard to imagine 4 teams from one conference are going to go to the 16-team playoff field. So the stakes, enormous.
Right. I don't see 4 teams, maybe 3, but 2 for sure.
Fourth and 2 for Georgia Southern. Z. Walden, the man in motion, and he gets the pitch and fumbles it. Furman looks like it's recovered the football, a huge defensive stand.
Well, that's the momentum you were talking about. Maybe that's what they need. Big crowd, a lot of emotions going on out there. They have to get something going. And that time, Z. Walden, he just dropped the football. Set up very well. Ball's in, ball's out. He would have gotten the first down. He takes his eye off the football because he looked up to see where his blocker was, Mark Myers, 34. Watch his head. See, he looked up, and now the ball's on the ground. But Rodney Johnson, 25, he was right there to come up to make the play.
We've talked how Georgia Southern has had a tendency to fumble the football. But also remember, they recovered a fumble on the kickoff that started them at the 20-yard line, and to get no points is a big swing for Furman. But Tarico O'Neill on the carry gets a couple of yards. It'll be second and long. Furman needs to do something with this possession.
Well, they do, and also you got to credit Derek Butler for staying at home, because Furman is going to try to come back and use that big offensive line, try to push the ball off tackle, try to make some things happen, try to really disguise some things on offense, and they're going to try to hit some big plays down the field. But right now, defensively, Georgia Southern, they're playing a very good football game.
Second and 7 for the Paladins from their own 19-yard line. Napier out of the shotgun. Quick pass, and a short gain for Isaac West. That, in many ways, a dangerous pass.
Also, 51, James Burchett. He's coming in on the blitz. And what I like about this defense is this. They are, I think, confusing Napier. They talked about disrupting the timing, getting into his head, making him make decisions quicker than he would like. So far, defensively, they're doing that because they felt like Napier is a very good quarterback, a heads-up quarterback that can put his team in good situations. So far, defensively, they've won that chess match.
Huge third down conversion opportunity. Furman, number one in the conference on third down conversions. Third and seven, Napier hits O'Neill. He's got the first down and more across the 35. That's a big play that Furman had to have.
For those are the type of plays they need on this football team. Forget about the offense for a moment. Defensively, they're okay, but they need the lift to get their minds into this game. Just a little hide route. He's going to come back underneath. And you see there, O'Neill, he finds a lot of green grass. He has a first down. But I think most importantly, Paul, he has a big play, something they haven't had so far this afternoon.
First and 10. Furman out to its own 37-yard line. Napier on the flea flicker. Looking for Isaac West and overthrowing everyone. That did not fool Georgia Southern. Let's go down to Jim Noble.
You saw Tariqo O'Neill make that last catch. They call him the prophet here at Furman, and this is why. Last year in the 2001 playoffs against Lehigh, after rushing for 133 yards and two touchdowns, O'Neill produced from his shoe a piece of paper on which, before the game, he had written 129 yards and two touchdowns. Therefore, the prediction, he is now the prophet.
Well, that works.
Well, I'll let this play go, and then I'll come back with something else.
All right, second and 10 after the incompletion. Napier out of the shotgun. Finds Henley Brigham out of the backfield. A short gain. It'll be third and long.
Well, I want to go back to the flea flicker, Paul. You said it didn't look good, which it didn't, because, number one, James Young knocked off Isaac West. A flag should have been thrown because it hit him after the 5 yards, and that's why it was an ugly-looking play, because the receiver couldn't get down the field.
Well, now it'll be third and seven for the Paladins. And once again, they're faced with a big third down situation. 56.1% of the time this season, that's tops in the conference, they've converted third downs. They had one a moment ago, and they need another here. Napier out of the shotgun with the option. This is Brigham, and Brigham gets a whole lot of nothing, loses about 4 yards on the play.
Freddie Pesceda. Does that name sound familiar?
Yes.
Number 44 in white. He's making a difference. He gets into the backfield. I was very surprised that they ran an option there, but he gets into the backfield, disrupts the timing, and then number 43, Derek Butler, he finishes. And that's why that play was an ugly-looking play.
Pesceda now with 11 tackles for loss on the season. He is a big game player, and he's been coming up big for Georgia Southern so far this afternoon. On to punt for Furman is Bo Moore. And the always dangerous Ant Williams waiting, but he shows a fair catch. And Georgia Southern will start from its own 30-yard line when we come back. These two teams, Furman and Georgia Southern, after each other as the rivalry.
You're watching Fox Sports Net.
Welcome back to Greenville, South Carolina. Georgia Southern blanking Furman in the second quarter, 14-0. You know, Mike Siwak is in his rookie year as head coach at Georgia Southern, and what a coaching legacy this guy has to live up to. Of course, it all began with Irk Russell, the original Georgia Dome, who resurrected the program in 1982. Three national titles for Irk in 85, 86, and 89. Tim Stowers, all he did was win a national title in his rookie year, 1990. And after a bit of a down period by Eagle standards, Paul Johnson, Irk's former offensive coordinator, came back to Statesboro, five straight conference titles and two more national championships. So, guys, you think Mike Siwak's had it easy? Oh, everywhere he goes in Statesboro, Georgia, he hears about the level that he has to live up to.
Oh, that's right, Jim. Nobody thought Mike Siwak had it easy, though. And, you know, Irk Russell shocked the world when he left Georgia as its longtime defensive coordinator to take the job at Georgia Southern. And goodness knows, Georgia Southern's defense has been outstanding today, pitching a shutout thus far.
They played extremely well.
But the offense has looked good as well. It's the offense which has the ball at its own 30-yard line. Chaz Williams calling his own number. Pickup of about four. It'll bring up a second and six. Chaz Williams inching his way into the record books for Georgia Southern. He's approaching the 60-yard mark on the day. We've talked about how he's had six consecutive 100-yard rushing games. His two touchdowns in this game having tied the school record for the regular season by a quarterback for rushing touchdowns. He has 18 on the season. Again, Chaz Williams, the sophomore, running this complex triple-option offense. He's in his first year, and Williams drops back, wants to throw up over the top, and that's Seawald and open for a big play deep inside Furman territory. Mike Seawald says, when we throw it, we mean it, and he ain't kidding.
No, he's not, but also he said, we practice one play all week long, and I guess this is the play that they practice because it works. Seawald and wide open, and number 14, you can say, Paul Billingsley, he saw it. It wasn't as if it was a surprise. He saw the back. He saw the quarterback. He just could not make the play.
Well, you get him thinking, run, 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 and all of a sudden, up over the top, nothing but running room off the pass. So with the big play at the 31, Williams on the keeper, cuts it back inside. The referee looks like he throws a block, and Williams will be close to a first down.
Well, Charles Clark, number 74, his big center, got in the way. But what you're seeing is an offense that has gotten the engine running. I mean, they have this Furman defense on their heels. They've run the football. Everybody has gotten involved. They've now come back and thrown the football. And when you get drawn into the run, you have a chance of giving up those big pass plays, Paul, as we've seen. So I look for them to come back and try another pass play here soon, but they're going to keep it on the ground.
Second and very short. Z. Walden, the man in motion, and the man who gets the pitch. Running room inside the 10. Z. Walden to the end zone. Touchdown.
Where you going to see 57, Travis Jones. He was right there on the play, and also 23, Cedric Ritter. Both guys, again, they take the quarterback, they leave the pitch back. That's why nobody's there. And that's why you have to really concentrate on your reads. See, right there, you got two guys. All right, who's on the running back? Nobody. Because Chaz Williams, with his effectiveness on the ground, he's drawing all the attention.
And they've run that play several times. Z. Walden, a man in motion, and the man who gets the pitch virtually every time he's gone in motion.
Well, that was the play he fumbled on. This time he catches it, you know.
The extra point is up and good, and all of a sudden, Georgia Southern has taken command of this ball game. 21-0, Z. Walden, the 21-yarder, and we'll be right back. Welcome back to Greenville, South Carolina, where Georgia Southern has grabbed control late in the second quarter, 21-0. This fall, get your NFL fix a day earlier with the most outrageous, unpredictable NFL pregame show you've ever seen. Introducing the NFL show on Fox Sports Net with Michael Irvin, Tony Siragusa, and comedian Tommy Davidson. So start your NFL weekend the night before kickoff with the NFL show presented by the U.S. Postal Service. Tonight, after college football, and tomorrow morning at 10:30 Eastern only on Fox Sports Net. Mike Seawalk and his Georgia Southern Eagles having grabbed control of this game, and the one thing Bobby Lamb and Furman did not want to see was big plays on first down. They've seen it all day. Georgia Southern already at 220 yards rushing. And kicking off again, Brian Bratton controls the football, but not his health, and loses the football as he gets popped. Bratton's second fumble on the kickoffs, and once again, Georgia Southern will have an extremely short field to work with.
And it's the same guy. Number 80, Carl Kearney. He is making plays. This guy is just a special teams demon. And so he comes in also 51, Burchett. He gets a big hit. These guys of Georgia Southern, they're playing very well in all phases. Special teams, offense, defense, and Furman, they had a week off. They had 2 weeks to prepare, and maybe, you know, that's why they're flat, but you still would get up for your, I'm going to say, one of your biggest rivals.
But Bratton, after already having fumbled, did not protect the football the way he needed to, ran into his own blocker, and the ball popped out. Chaz Williams and the Georgia Southern Eagles in business again. Off the pitch is Mark Myers. He's inside the five. It'll be first and goal for Georgia Southern.
Well, you go back to defensive coordinator Steve Wilson a few series ago, and Jim Noble touched on it. Talking about getting off the blocks with his defensive linemen, with his linebackers. They are not getting off the blocks. And that time, Brandon Poole, 93, he was able to get off the block somewhat, but he wasn't fast enough to get to the outside to cut the back off.
And now it's first and goal for Georgia Southern at Furman's 2-yard line. The Eagles close to blowing this thing wide open. Williams on the keeper, approaches the goal line, touchdown, Chaz Williams, his third of the game, and Georgia Southern adds to its lead.
Well, you look at the turnovers. We talked about them being huge in this football game, and they have been with Georgia Southern. Furman, they were able to get the ball back with a turnover. They've done nothing with it. And coming into this football game, you have to control the offense. That hasn't been done by this defense. You have to play very good offense to keep the ball away from this offense. That hasn't happened. I mean, this is a running machine, and now they appear to just stop at the filling station, gassed up, and say, let's run on up the road and keep running.
Georgia Southern punches home the point after, and with a minute 41 to go in the second quarter, the Eagles have a 28-0 lead. Chaz Williams, with his 3 rushing touchdowns in this game, has now erased Tracy Ham's name from the Georgia Southern record book. 19 rushing touchdowns for Williams on the year. That's a new school record for a Georgia Southern quarterback.
Well, they like to slam that fullback in there to really draw all the defenders and let him get tackled, and then they'll send that quarterback right behind him. They've run that play twice, and they've gotten a touchdown on each occasion. So you got to start paying attention to the quarterback, because they've already stated that Austin is not really that big punishing, bruising runner in there, so they give it to the quarterback.
Boy, when they get to the locker room, Bobby Lamb will undoubtedly have an earful for his Paladins. Stay tuned. Coming up at halftime, we'll look at the great history of the Southern Conference, and Jim Noble will talk live with Southern Conference Commissioner Danny Morrison. We'll look at tonight's Pac-10 game on Fox Sports Net between California and Arizona State, including a feature on the Sun Devils running backs that they call the Trio. We'll talk to both coaches and, of course, have highlights of the first half, which to this point have all belonged to Georgia Southern, which kicks to Furman. With more than a minute and a half to go, the Paladins need to have something positive. Brian Bratton with the football. The flag is down. So is Bratton at the 33-yard line. We'll see what happens.
I think that's holding, but also a good return by Bratton. I mean, he's had 2 mishaps. He's come back and say, okay, I got to catch this one. I can't lay this one on the ground. It goes through your mind after a period of time.
Perhaps he's been trying to do just too much. Again, we mentioned how he led the nation in kickoff returns a year ago, averaging more than 37 yards per return. This year, it's been a much different story. He's felt like a marked man, but when you don't take care of the football, you mark yourself.
During the return, holding by the receiver.
Critics are calling the best damn sports show period a 2-hour frat party with irreverent skits, insightful interviews, and sharp locker room banter. The best damn sports show period every weeknight at 8 and 11 only on Fox Sports Net. Well, as if Furman wasn't in a deep enough hole, with just over a minute and a half to go, down by 28, the holding penalty pushes them back to their own 16-yard line. Forget the run. Furman has got to throw. Napier looking for Isaac West over the middle. Leads him too much. It's incomplete.
Well, Furman practices the 2-minute offense every Monday, and now they're having a chance to run it. Now, I don't know how successful they will be, but they have that chance. But I want to go back to something else on the defensive side. What Georgia Southern has done, they've taken away the underneath routes, the crossing routes. So Napier really has nowhere to throw the ball. They've also taken away the deep routes. Defensively, they've scouted this football team very well.
Napier again with 4 wide receivers, swung to both sides of the field. Down 28-0 out of the shotgun. Napier looking. Now has to run out of trouble, but he can't get there. Freddie Pesceta brings him down.
Well, the big man, the big All-American, and going back to the defense, I can't say it enough how well they have scouted this football team and how well they're playing, because Napier has nowhere to go. Because at some point in time, you find some weak links. you find something. And offensively, Furman has found nothing but a lot of white jerseys in their faces.
And now Georgia Southern obviously able to pin its ears back and come after Napier big time.
Well, when you have a 28-point lead, you know Furman doesn't want to turn the ball over again, and they don't want to come out here now and really give them the ball back in decent field position, which they might because it's third down, actually third and 16, a passing situation. You kind of stuck between a rock and a hard place. We haven't played very well. We've turned the ball over. We have to do something. We don't want to give them the great field position. Paul, so say, okay, you're standing over, and I'm pretty sure Bobby Lamb is scratching his head. What can we call for it to be successful? Because so far they haven't had any success on offense.
Well, so much at stake, as we've mentioned, for both of these teams. Georgia Southern playing its final conference game of the year, win it, and the Eagles are assured of nothing worse than a tie for the conference title. But Furman, already having lost a conference game on that wild finish at Appalachian, can ill afford to lose this one or their conference hopes will be over. Wofford, waiting for Furman next week, is the team with a chance to tie Georgia Southern if the Eagles are able to hang on. So Furman has a minute to go in the first half and then needs to work on all sorts of adjustments to climb back into this football game if that's going to happen. Third and 16 for Billy Napier and the Paladins, who are in a world of trouble deep in their own territory. Napier needing to throw with time and again misses Tarico O'Neill there, but Ethan, with third and long, at best that would have been short.
Well, nobody was open. And I've said it before, and I probably will keep repeating this. The secondary of the Eagles, they're very good. They have taken away the deep routes. The linebackers are taking away the underneath routes. And I think Georgia Southern, they are playing this football game like this is their last conference game, and they want to make a statement, and they don't want to put it in the hands of someone else.
Well, the statement has been made throughout the first half, that's for sure. The punt under great pressure, able to get away, and Ant Williams bobbles the ball but hangs on. And again, Georgia Southern, we may not have much time left in the second quarter, but they've got a short field to work with in Furman territory at the 45.
Well, you and I both know this is not a passing football team. So I think they're going to come back and continue to do what they've done well, run the football. They will have one play. Although we've seen one, they might have two. In terms of the passing plays, that they can sneak something in there. But if I'm firming on defense, I'm not playing the pass. I'm playing the run because they've run long gainers time after time again.
That was a 35-yard punt. So Georgia Southern starting at Furman's 45-yard line. Chaz Williams and company with a minute to go here in the second quarter. Z. Walden in motion again. Again, Z. Walden gets the pitch, but this time Paul Billingsley and the Furman defense have an answer.
Well, they have an answer. I tell you what. What I'm seeing also is Furman not being able to match up with Georgia Southern in terms of speed. Georgia Southern, you know, they have the speed to get to the outside. Those slot backs are very fast. The quarterback, really all the skill guys on Georgia Southern's football team, they're very skilled and they're very fast. I think Furman, they're having a problem of matching that speed once that speed gets to the outside. Because when you look at their pursuit angles, they're taking the proper angles. It just can't get there.
Cedric Ritter, the Paladin, shaken up on the play. You can see Mike Killian down with him. Ritter and all those linebackers, they've had angles, and they've been chasing and chasing and chasing all day. Let's go downstairs to Jim Noble.
Well, as you guys talk about Z. Walden, I prefer to call him Z, but here's why. Zareem Walden actually has five names. His full name, Zareem Lawrence Renee Marcel Walden. So, Paul, every time number 20 catches the ball, I certainly expect you to call him by his full name from now on.
Or his initial, and I know this, a defense has got to be wide awake to grab those Zs. Chaz Williams wants to throw, and there's Z. Walden all alone. Touchdown. Again, they don't throw often, but they get big plays, and there's a flag down on the field. We'll see if this is going to come back.
I'll just call him Z, the playmaker. How about that? Forget about all those other names. And it goes against Furman, roughing the passer, so touchdown for Z. Walden. And I mean, that's why I said about these slot backs. They're quick, they're fast, they're in the passing game. These guys are all over the place, and you really have to be aware of where they are. I mean, Z. Walden, he has just all-out sure money right here. Touchdown.
No purple jerseys in the picture at all.
At all. Where's the defense?
Coming into this game, Walden averaged 20 yards per catch, also averaged over 11 yards per carry. Everywhere you look on this Georgia Southern team, guys who make big plays.
And this is a guy that almost quit the football team. He wasn't playing. He went on scout team. He came back, and now he's a starter. And he also is a guy that's a leader on this football team that really has helped Chaz Williams come along.
A year ago, Walden was moved to defensive back, but then moved back to a slot back position. And again, as you mentioned, the senior has certainly been a leader on the team this year. The point after is good, and Georgia Southern's lead climbs to 35-0. Let's take a look again. We mentioned that Georgia Southern does not pass often, but when they do, it's extremely effective.
What happened to the secondary was that they went into a man coverage. The middle of the field opened up. Z. Walden, he got behind the linebacker, between the linebackers and the safeties. Nobody there, and that's why he's so wide open, because of the success they've had on the ground.
And, Ethan, this game is moving very quickly from an old-fashioned rivalry into a real butt-whipping.
Well, the score indicates that, I believe. I mean, you can't have that big 3-5 on one side, that 0 on the other side, but Bobby Lamb right now, he's probably embarrassed. I mean, a big crowd. We talked about the crowd yesterday. We talked about his team wanting this game, being at home. I mean, it had, or it still has, they can come back, all the elements that's needed in terms of the motivation and getting your guys ready to play football. And for some reason, they've been flat, and maybe it's the week off they had.
It was also interesting how Coach Lamb yesterday made it very clear how much he wanted to run the football, how much he wanted to control the time of possession. But on the first possession of the game, Furman came out throwing.
Well, not only that, they haven't been able to do anything. They haven't sustained the rushing attack. The passing game hasn't been there, because defensively, Georgia Southern, they've taken everything away. In my mind, it's just been total domination, really, on the defensive side, which has set up the offense based on the field position and how they play.
Well, Furman has over 30 seconds to try to do something before they get to the locker room. The penalty brings the kick from the 50. It falls out of bounds, so Furman will start from its own 20-yard line. And Georgia Southern is adding to what's already been incredible success. We talked about 6 national championships, again, back-to-back in 1989 and back-to-back again in 99 and 2000. They've been national runners-up on 2 occasions, 6 conference championships the last 5 in a row, and they are looking every bit the champion today.
Well, you mentioned revenge earlier. These two teams met twice last year in Statesboro. They split. But you look at the playoffs, that's where Furman won. And I think that's why Georgia Southern has come into this game, Paul, with a vengeance. Like, hey, they knocked us out of the playoffs. At Georgia Southern, they don't talk about winning the Southern Conference, because it's expected. They want the bigger prize, which is getting to the playoffs to win a championship. And there's nothing wrong with that, because I think that's what you should do. Hey, forget about the conference. We want to win championships, and they've gotten plenty of those.
Corey Tant getting his first carry of the game from the fullback position. 3-yard pickup from Billy Napier with a little play action, hoping to find somebody open, waiting. Isaac West comes back to the football, but he's out of bounds. It's incomplete, and we've got zeros on the clock. So mercifully, the first half has come to an end for Furman in what's been a dominating performance by Georgia Southern thus far.
Very dominating, Paul. I also thought Furman's offense, I thought they would be able to spread some things around. They haven't. Georgia Southern, you got to credit their coaching staff.
And let's go downstairs to Jim Noble, who's with the Georgia Southern head coach.
All right, Coach. Well, heck of a game plan. 35-0. So dominating performance. Did you have any idea this was brewing?
No, not at all. Not at all. I think they did. They by any means won't let this thing happen. They're a quality school. Those guys have had 2 weeks to prepare for us. They've been fighting hard. They know that what's going to happen out here in the second half. We're going to get a different look by Furman. The turnovers, again. I wish to heck we hadn't turned it over twice, because we gave away points, and when they turned it over, we got the points. So that's going to be the biggest thing for them. They got to try to find a way to just hold on to the football.
All right, Coach, thanks. Go talk to your team. Folks, this is not what we thought would happen, but it is happening here at Paladin Stadium.
Georgia Southern 35, Furman 0. You're watching Southern Conference Football on Fox Sports Net.
Welcome back to Greenville, South Carolina, where Paladin Stadium is in a state of shock. Georgia Southern has dominated Furman 35-0. It was just 7-0 at the end of the first quarter before that powerful triple option offense of Georgia Southern put 28 points on the board in the second quarter, which, by the way, tied a school record for most points for the second quarter. The last time Georgia Southern did that, 28 on the board in the second, was against Youngstown State in the 1999 National Championship game. The quarterback for Georgia Southern, Chaz Williams, a sophomore running this triple option for the first time. Well, his first season doing it, and he sure looks like a seasoned veteran, Ethan.
Well, we talked about Chaz Williams. We talked about the maturity. We talked about the fumbles. We talked about the big plays. I mean, this kid leads the conference in rushing. Their rushing attack is very powerful. They get a lot of guys involved, Paul. I think that's why they're leading this football game, because they have so many weapons. And right now, offensively, they all are clicking.
His three rushing touchdowns set a new standard for Georgia Southern. 19 on the season, a new mark set for quarterbacks at Georgia Southern. And let's go down to the field and Jim Noble with Furman head coach Bobby Lamb, who must have had quite a halftime.
Paul, thank you. Coach, what do you tell your kids at halftime after a half in which everything that probably could have went wrong for them?
Everything obviously went wrong. Georgia Southern outplayed us from special teams, offense, and defense. And when I told them we can do two things, we can turn over and quit, or we can raise up and show our pride and our passion for Furman football, and we can come out here and execute. We haven't executed. They've out-executed us, and all the credit goes to Georgia Southern.
Is it simply a case of them winning a lot of their one-on-one battles, or are they doing anything tricky to you?
No, they're not doing a single thing we haven't seen on tape. They're executing. They've gotten a couple of key turnovers. We're not doing anything special team-wise to help ourselves out.
Bobby, thank you. Good join your team. Good luck in the second half. We'll see what Bobby Lamb has got cooked up. Georgia Southern with a 35-point lead. Your second half is next.
Welcome back to Paladin Stadium, where Furman trails Georgia Southern 35-0. Paul Crane, Ethan Horton, and Jim Noble with you in what's been a shocking one-sided game.
Very shocking. I'll tell you what, I didn't expect anything like this.
And how about this for Furman, Ethan? They've got to kick it off to Georgia Southern to start the second half. A deep kick, Ant Williams back in the back part of his end zone, and he can't be thinking about bringing that out, and he won't. Nice job by Danny Marshall. And finally, a highlight for Furman, but that's it. Let's take a look at our Microtel Inns and Suites first half stats. And the score is dominating, Ethan. Total yards dominating. 321 yards of offense for Georgia Southern in the first half. Furman less than 100, and points off turnovers.
Well, I look at the rushing attack of Furman. It's non-existent. 20 yards to 243. I mean, they talked about rushing the football, keeping the ball away from Georgia Southern. 20 yards, that will not get it on the ground.
No, it won't. 14 carries for 20 yards, and the team wanted to establish the run. Hasn't done that. They're in a deep, deep hole, but Georgia Southern starts, and the redshirt freshman, Jermaine Austin, flag goes down. And we'll wait and see what happens.
Well, when you look at this rushing attack, it's only two people, Chaz Williams and also Jermaine Austin.
Well, illegal motion, and that'll bring Georgia Southern back, but it's been a dominating rushing performance.
Very dominating, Paul. It started with Chaz Williams. They come back with Jermaine Austin, and now you throw in Z. Walden, Mark Myers. I mean, offensively, they've given Furman a lot of looks. The whirly bird option, the quick pitch, the sweep. So defensively, you have to prepare for responsibility type of football opposed to reacting, and I think this football team of Georgia Southern, they've caught Furman reacting opposed to taking care of the responsibilities, and that's why they have 35 points.
React to the football and leave a hole, it becomes very costly. You mentioned Furman with only 20 yards rushing. Talking about this running game of Georgia Southern, 243 yards on the ground in the first half. And Chaz Williams on the keeper pushes it up a couple of yards. And again, Georgia Southern not only leads the nation in 1AA with yards rushing, but leads the entire nation, 1A as well.
Well, that's why this offense is very hard to defend, because you don't see it all the time. I mean, you have to be in this conference to see an awful lot, really, on an annual basis. But outside of this conference, there's not a lot of people running this style of offense. You look at Georgia Southern, Wofford, I think one of the surprise teams in this league. And you got to say to yourself, it must be something about this offense. I guess you can say it's been very successful over the years because they haven't changed a thing.
Chaz Williams on the keeper, gets across the 20, but barely beyond what was the original line of scrimmage. So it's going to be third and long.
And the thing about this offense is it offers balance between individuals. You look at Austin, Williams, Walding, 85 yards rushing, 80, 60, three touchdowns, one touchdown. So you have to take care of what you're assigned to on a defense. And if you don't see it very often, which on defense some of these Furman players have not, it causes problems.
And if they don't have one star to key on, everywhere you look, great players who can make big plays. Third and seven for Georgia Southern. First possession of the second half. Chaz Williams on the option. And the pitch to Z Walden breaks one tackle across the 25. And Furman gets exactly what it needs, a defensive stop in the first series of the second half.
Well, 93, Brandon Poole, he makes the play. And when you play this style of offense, your defensive ends must be heavily involved in stopping the run. First half, they weren't involved. This particular play, as I said before, Brandon Poole, he was able to get involved in the play, and that's why we're looking at fourth down.
Well, Bear Reinhart back to receive what will be his first punt of the day. Scott Shelton on to boot it away, and he gets away a beauty. High spiral Reinhart forced to make the fair catch, and he does so at about the 36-yard line. Let's go down to Jim Noble with a special guest.
Paul, thank you. I'm joined by Walter Payton Award winner and former Furman All-American running back Lewis Ivory. And I tell you what, the last time these two teams played on this field, you ran for about 300 yards against these Georgia Southern Eagles. A little different this time around.
Yes, very different. You know, Georgia Southern had their backs against the wall, and they came out fighting. And I think you can look at the score and tell that this is a good football team.
Lewis, I know you're working right now in the Furman Athletic Department in marketing, but I know your eyes are still on that NFL dream. How are you? How healthy are you right now?
I'm 100% right now, and the timing of my injury was terrible, but right now I'm working out and hoping that I can go to Europe at the beginning of the year. So.
Okay, well, we wish you the best of luck. Want to see you in an NFL camp next summer. And guys, if you well know, for the last 4 years or so, it was the Lewis Ivory and, of course, Adrian Peterson show here in the Southern Conference.
Oh, you got that right, Jim. Two great backs, and goodness, Furman certainly misses Lewis Ivory. Lamar Rembert on the carry there, and he was fortunate to get back to the line of scrimmage. It'll be second and 10.
Well, also, I think Ivory will get a great chance in NFL Europe, a chance to develop and then come back to the NFL.
Napier, play action, wants to throw, and hits Isaac West. First down, West out of bounds, and all of a sudden, Furman able to get something done, which it was not able to do in the first half.
So what's the score?
Well, 35-0.
So that helps. But he has great time, and Napier delivers the football. This is what I expected during the first half, and I hope they start this half and much better than they did in the first half.
Well, certainly they cannot yet be thinking about what would be the biggest comeback in Southern Conference history, but also even a journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step, and they're trying to take their first step here, keeping the ball on the ground. That would be Lamar Rembert, and again, very short pickup, so Herman will be in second and long.
Well, Freddie Pesceta gets involved in the defense, but also, Paul, going back to this defense, you know, these guys are playing very well. Now, if Furman comes back to win this game, total letdown by the defense.
Second and 9 from the Georgia Southern 45. Napier again wants to throw. There's Bear Reinhart across the 30 and out of bounds. First down for Furman.
See, Deion Stokes, here's a guy that hasn't been starting, hasn't played an awful lot. Reinhart, he makes the completion. But these are the type of things I expected from Furman. Attack the weaknesses. I think he's a weakness on his defense because he hasn't played. Keys has played. Wilkerson has played. And then you flip the script. Furman, on the other hand, they have some young linebackers. The coordinators of both teams, I guess you would say, you look at Southern and you look at Furman. You know, they've gone out and game planned this game totally differently. Furman on defense, weaknesses. They've been taken care of.
Billy Napier and Furman inside the Georgia Southern 30. The pitch to Lamar Rembert. Rembert down to the 25 before being brought down. The man they call Shakes was not able to shake loose from that tackler, James Burchett, and it'll be second and about seven.
No, he wasn't, Paul, but watch the white jerseys. Look where they are along the line of scrimmage. They are in the backfield of the Paladins. They are not giving an inch, although the score is 35 to nothing. They're playing as if it's 0-0, and they're winning the point of attack.
Second and eight. From the 25-yard line, Napier under center. And Napier on the option, pitches to Rembert. Rembert looking for room and not finding any. He's brought down at the line of scrimmage, no gain.
David Young, and that's what I'm talking about when you mention responsibilities, you mention awareness. Now, this is an option play. Watch Young. He takes his drop. He reacts. Now he has the back. He makes the play because he's right there to make the play. I mean, Rembert has nowhere to go because 18 is all over him.
One of the best safeties in the history of this school, an All-American and a four-year starter at Georgia Southern. But now Furman, third and eight from the Eagles' 25-yard line. Napier, three wide receivers spread, two backs behind him, wants to throw. And he dumps it over to Rembert out of the backfield. Across the 25, but shy of the 20, and he'll not make the first down. The Georgia Southern defense stops again.
Well, David Young, number 18, he's right there. And I can't say enough about this defense because standing up here, Napier has nowhere to throw the ball. You see, he has a nice pocket. It doesn't break down, but defensively, they are definitely looking up receivers, crossing the field, and they're going back to a spot, turning and looking guys up, and they're really defending the field very well, and that's why he's having to dump the ball off because he can't throw the ball down the field.
And trailing 35-0, everything is fourth down territory, so Furman going for it. 1-for-2 on the day, 10-for-11 on the year on fourth down conversions, and Napier wants to throw with time up top. Isaac West, touchdown.
Well, they got one. Finally. And they got after the same guy they've been going after, a flag down, 26, Aaron Whitaker.
We'll see if they get to hold on to what they got with a flag down on the field, but Furman trying to inch its way back. Offside defense, that'll be declined. Count the touchdown, and Furman is on the board.
Well, Napier threw a nice touch pass between the defenders. I didn't think the ball was going to get there. I thought it was going to be batted down, but he just throws it in there. It's so nice. I mean, watch the loft on the football. So you see the safety coming over. He can't get there, and now you see the 6 points, and Whitaker, he's beaten on the play. James Young, number one, the safety could not come over.
Well, Isaac West, there's speed guy able to run under the football, and the point after is good, so Furman takes the first step of what would clearly be a lengthy journey. Billy Napier and Isaac West trying to help Dick Furman out of a very deep hole. It's now 35-7 midway through the third quarter. Southern Conference football on Fox Sports Net is brought to you by your Carolina Ford dealers, driving the Carolinas. By Microtel Inns and Suites, Microtel, get a room. By Pepsi, the joy of Pepsi. And by Bilo Supermarkets, everybody's favorite way to save. Furman on the scoreboard, finally cutting into what had been a 35-0 halftime deficit. Eight plays, 64 yards. You can see it took just over 3.5 minutes, and that's clearly Furman's best possession of the day.
Well, they were able to hit some passes. They still are unable to run the ball for huge gains. I mean, you take 3-4, hit a pass play here or there, you have a touchdown, and I think they want more out of their running game, but they'll take the 7 points.
Isaac West having caught the touchdown pass that puts Furman on the board, and Danny Marshall gets the opportunity to kick to Anthony Williams. Williams, one opportunity to return a kick, opening the second half as a touchback as it went deep into the end zone. And he's a dangerous returner, averaging over 30 yards a return. And obviously, Furman wants no part of kicking it to him. It goes out of bounds, and Furman will start in pretty good field position. This fall, get your NFL fix a day earlier with the most outrageous, unpredictable NFL pregame show you've ever seen. Introducing the NFL show on Fox Sports Net with Michael Irvin, Tony Siragusa, and comedian Tommy Davidson. So start your NFL weekend the night before kickoff with the NFL Show, presented by the U.S. Postal Service. Tonight, after college football, and tomorrow morning at 10:30 Eastern, only on Fox Sports Net. Georgia Southern will start at its own 35-yard line. Furman finally on the board. Southern's lead cut to 35-7. First and 10, Chaz Williams, who's got three rushing touchdowns of his own today. Williams on the keeper, gets to about the 38-yard line, and we've got a little frustration out there. The flag's flown, and the way Furman is clapping, it looks like it will go against Southern.
Well, that's a good penalty for Furman, because they need all the help they can get. And not to say that flag was thrown to help them, but at least try to let them get back into the football game.
Z. Walden seemed to be mixing it up there, and will wait on the call. And the personal foul will move it 15 yards. And Furman, again, we talked about needing a single step. Even a journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step. Well, they've got a deep journey. And Mike Seawalk cannot be happy with what he's seen here in the early going of the second half.
Well, I'm pretty sure he's not, because the tide can turn. And a lot of times when you have a big lead, your team has a tendency to just kind of falling asleep just a little bit. And maybe now with these penalties and with the 6 points, or 7 points actually, that Furman has scored, it will force Georgia Southern to refocus on this game.
Second and 22 for Chaz Williams. T.J. Anderson, the man in motion, and Williams wants to throw. Comes back to Derek Owens, who makes his first reception of the day. Shy of the 30-yard line. Some other games in the Southern Conference today include 14th-ranked Appalachian State all over VMI. Chattanooga with its first conference win of the year, beating the Citadel, and Wofford at East Tennessee State later tonight. A big one for Wofford, as they too have just one loss in conference. Wofford, the 15th ranked team in the nation. Third and 16. This is not the specialty for Georgia Southern.
Well, they like to keep the ball on the ground. Well, he's changing the play at the line of scrimmage.
And T.J. Anderson, the man in brief motion. And the pitch comes to Mark Myers. Speedy Mark Myers. All sorts of running room down the right sideline, and he is gone. Touchdown, Georgia Southern answers just like that.
Mark Myers should credit Chaz Williams for the score. Now, Chaz Williams, Mark Myers should credit Carl Kearney for the touchdown.
He threw a big one.
Yes, he did. But smart play by the quarterback, by seeing something on defense, changing the play. I mean, what can you say? It's for six. I mean, not only was it for a short six, Bobby, I mean, you're talking about 6 points, a long gainer. I mean, this is what Coach Seawalk was talking about. I want my quarterback to grow. I think he has grown, and he is going to play in a lot of big football games. And this is probably his first game, definitely not his last game. But you can see he's starting to understand what his offense wants and the positions that they want to be in.
A 71-yard touchdown run, the first time Georgia Southern has converted a third down longer than 11 yards all year long. And they did it in the biggest of ways. Southern back on top, 40. Georgia Southern has answered the Furman touchdown here in the third quarter to stretch its lead back to 35. And they do it on the option. Mark Myers, 71 yards.
Well, good blocking. You're going to see at the point of attack, 93, Brandon Poole. We're going to circle him there. See, he's right in position. Do you take the quarterback? Do you take the back? He misses. All right, you go back out there now to T.J. Anderson. He's throwing a block on T.J. Wilson. He's taking care of him. Now it's up to Mark Myers. You would think he would run out of bounds. No, he dips back in and come back. And now you see Kearney, Carl Kearney, getting a block down the field, Mr. Special Teams. And that's why this play was effective. A, right choice by the quarterback, but then you had other players come in and they made good blocks and they really got the back down the field.
It didn't take long for Georgia Southern to answer that Furman touchdown. And we talked about Myers at the top of the telecast as perhaps being the fastest guy among those slot backs, and he certainly showed it there. 71 yards for the touchdown to stretch the lead back to 35. Scott Shelton to kick to Brian Bratton, who has had all sorts of problems for Furman today. He's got the football and down at the 25, and the good news for Bratton is he still has the football when the play was over.
But he's down now, so I don't know if it was good or bad, but he's limping off. And this has been a very physical game, and this is something that you and I talked about from a standpoint of, you know, we've seen a few games now, but we really haven't seen the physical game. And today, Furman just not had, they haven't been up to the task. I mean, look at this hit right here. That's physical football, and Georgia Southern definitely has brought that to the party today.
Jonathan Wilkerson on the hit there on special teams. Georgia Southern certainly bringing its A game and a physical nature along with it. First and 10 for the Paladins at their own 25-yard line. The give goes to Tariqa O'Neill. O'Neill back to the line of scrimmage. A lot of work for no gain, but once again, Freddie Pesceta on the play.
Well, O'Neill's probably tired because he was the last person to run onto the field, and he gets the football. So he ran, what, 50 yards to the field and maybe another 10 or 15 to try to get to the outside. So, you know, you look at what's taking place here, and I like what Georgia Southern has done. You know, they took the approach, we're going to be physical. The seniors have really taken over this football team, and I think that's why this game is what it is, because they've been around, they've been to the championships, and they understand the importance of big games, and they have everyone playing at a higher level.
This is O'Neill again, who works for maybe a yard, and Furman quickly will be third and long.
Well, they've been in third and long all afternoon, pretty much.
They got off the bus third and long.
Good point. You're right. I mean, they start the game with a penalty. They go backwards, and they've been going backwards pretty much all day.
At their own 27, maybe 28-yard line, Billy Napier out of the shotgun. Three wide receivers, his buddy Bear Reinhardt in the slot to the right. Napier again has time up top for Isaac West, but again overthrown, and Napier not happy with himself.
Well, he was open because 26 Aaron Whitaker, he fell down. But all of Napier's passes today have been high, either high or behind the receiver. And he just doesn't appear to be that smooth operator that we've seen in the past.
Well, again, we mentioned how he came into the game as the number two quarterback in passing efficiency in the country. And he has not been very efficient today.
No, he hasn't.
So on to punt is Bo Moore. And hold on just a minute. The officials want to stop play. And Moore will have to do it again.
Well, Georgia Southern had a late substitution, 21, Deion Stokes.
Before the ball was snapped, we have a timeout on the defense.
Well, Georgia Southern has something to talk about here, and Moore will have to hurry up and wait. And I'm not sure, Ethan, how much there is to talk about at this point, because it's been complete, total domination by the Eagles.
Well, they were just making sure they had the right personnel on the field. And as I said before, they had a late addition to the return team, and I'm not sure they really were comfortable with what they saw out there, so they took the time out just to make sure.
Well, the Southern Sports Report is 30 minutes of nightly sports news completely dedicated to home teams throughout the South. It's nightly at 10 Eastern and 9 Central only on Fox Sports Net. And tomorrow night, the Falcons play the Seahawks. We'll talk about the Falcons and Steelers, Saints and Panthers, Texans and Titans. We'll also have our weekly sit-down with Georgia head coach Mark Richt and look at NASCAR from Phoenix, all on your Southern Sports Report tomorrow night. Well, now Georgia Southern has fixed whatever had ailed it.
But they haven't had a lot of problems today.
No, they have not. Just over 5.5 minutes to go here in the third quarter. Paul Crane, Ethan Horton, and Jim Noble along with you from Greenville, South Carolina, where Georgia Southern has put on a clinic on both sides of the ball. And now Bo Moore will punt to Ant Williams, the always dangerous Anthony Williams. Moore gets it away. Williams again wants a fair catch, gets it at his own 35, and Georgia Southern will start from there. When we come back, the Eagles and Paladins in what's been a one-sided game. Welcome back. Georgia Southern has put on what has been a rushing clinic, 329 yards on the ground for the Eagles in this game. And last year, both of these teams had to say goodbye to two of the best running backs in the history of the Southern Conference. Georgia Southern's Adrian Peterson, the league's all-time leading rusher. Numbers alone hardly tell the story of some of his spectacular efforts, but the numbers are staggering. 6,559 regular season yards in 4 years. Peterson went over 100 yards in 54 of his 57 games. Furman's Lewis Ivory. He had some big games, but no one has ever had a better season than Ivory had 2 years ago when he set a Southern Conference record with 2,079 yards, leading to his Walter Payton Award as 1AA's top offensive player. Peterson won the award in 99, and each of these players left huge holes which their teams have filled nicely. But Georgia Southern has filled extremely nicely.
Well, it helps when you have a quarterback.
No, really?
It helps. Jonathan Sutton's case, J.R. Revere, they lost him. Lost a lot of offense. Chaz Williams, he enters. They haven't lost too much there.
And Billy Napier certainly struggled today, though he is a Peyton Award finalist. You can see the dominating performance on the ground by Georgia Southern, which has the football again at its own 35-yard line. First and 10, Williams on the pitch. And again, another big game. T.J. Anderson with his biggest run of the game. And Ethan, Georgia Southern just keeps throwing players who can make big plays at you.
Well, they have speed guys. The same thing. 2-on-1. Over Dyke, 47. He can't get there. Just speed. And that's why you have these types of speed guys. Watch 44 killing. See, he can't get outside. Everybody's blocked. And when you have this type of blocking, you're 12 yards down the field.
Well, with Mark Myers and Z Walden perhaps a little gassed from their lengthy runs, bring in T.J. Anderson and Kevin Davis, and they don't miss a beat. Jermaine Austin hit at the line of scrimmage, the redshirt freshman fullback. Or check that, that's Chaz Williams on the keeper. And Williams, who lost the football, able to get on it. And again, Georgia Southern, that's been the one problem this year. Georgia Southern holding on to the football, but when you're up by 35, oh, you can make a mistake.
Well,
too.
Sometimes that's a problem with the triple option because a quarterback, he's reading. He's placing the ball in the belly of the fullback. He's also reading the down lineman, and he's reading the defense. And there are times when the fullback just won't put both arms on the ball, and the ball will pop out. Or in some cases, talking to the coaches, Chaz Williams, he'll see it and he reacts before he can actually do it. And sometimes he just lets the ball lie there and he shouldn't.
Oh, Williams reacts there, picks up a couple and gets back to the original line of scrimmage where it'll be third and 10. And we have seen some great running, but you know, Ethan, when it comes to running the football, no team has turned out more 1,000-yard rushers than North Carolina. Look at this guy. It's number 12 at Carolina. We refer to him affectionately as 88 because of the number he wore in the pros. But Ethan Horton, my partner, 1,000-yard tailback in 1984. First team All-ACC in 83 and 84. First team around here every week. But look, he had hair back then.
I don't have much of that right now, do I?
But you got great moves, big fella.
Yeah, good blocking.
Chaz Williams and Georgia Southern on third and 10, and hold on just a moment.
Well, they were throwing a pass, and they've been successful on the two that they have thrown.
I thought they were going to call a blast from the past penalty up here.
Yeah, right.
Delay a game on the offense. That's 5 yards. Third down, still third down.
Well, it's almost as though Georgia Southern has put itself to sleep in some ways. Could it be they're getting bored with the ball game?
Well, they can experiment. You and I both know, and pretty much everybody here knows, they don't throw the football. So now we're up 42-7. Let's try a few things.
Well, third and 16. We'll see what they try here. As Chaz Williams and the Eagles from the 44-yard line of Furman. Last time we saw them face a third and 16 was when Myers busted that 71-yarder. But straight drop back, Williams wants to throw and nearly picked off by Eddie Overdyke, who had a great opportunity there, and it literally slipped through his fingers.
Well, it did as a screenplay for Jermaine Austin. I mean, something we haven't seen, and Right now you say, okay, Obadiah, he has it. But he doesn't have it because he read the quarterback, he dropped off, and he didn't really rush the passer the entire time, and that's why he was in that throwing lane.
Well, he had to reach for it and at least knocked it away, and I guess we see one of the reasons why Georgia Southern doesn't necessarily throw the ball in typical fashion. A punting situation, and Scott Shelton gets it away. Bear Reinhart forced to call another fair catch, which he does at the 15-yard line, and it looks like he was not given the 2 yards for the halo. And that'll be just my guess on what this call would be, but the flag is down, and perhaps Reinhart was not given his room to make the fair catch.
No, you're right. Terrence McBride, a freshman. So a freshman getting a chance to come in and play just a little bit, get a little action, but he was just a little too close. But actually, he was in the proper position. Oh.
There it was, the halo rule. So a 41-yard punt gets reduced due to the penalty. And Furman will get a little better field position. As
kick the catch, interference on the kicking team, violating a 2 yard. It'll be 10 yards, first down.
So it'll be first and 10 for the Paladins, just across the 25, call it the 26-yard line. And again, trailing by 35 points with less than 3 minutes to play in the third quarter. Furman is not just in a world of hurt, but has got to hurry up. Billy Napier with the handoff to Hendley Brigham. Brigham, some tough yardage. Let's go down to Jim Noble.
Well, Paul, Bear Reinhart, who just fielded that last punt, certainly one of the more colorful characters on the field. He is nicknamed after the legendary coach Paul Bear Bryant, which sounds a lot cooler than William Stanley Reinhart III. He's a lead guitarist in a band here at Furman called Need to Breathe. They kind of bill themselves as the Beatles Go to Church, a little mix of gospel, British pop. Their latest song is entitled Feeble. You can insert your own punchline here.
Well, I'd like to insert a Beatles song. I know the one he needs now is Help.
Hey, I'll leave it alone since he has some gospel in there. I have a few thoughts over here.
Another penalty on Georgia Southern. And Furman's able to move the chains that way. I guess whatever works. But the whole Alabama connection, yes, Bear is named after Paul Bryant, but Bear's brother's name is Bryant.
So what do you call, hey, Bear Bryant, come here?
Then they both come. Their father, a huge Alabama fan. Furman with a first down at its own 38-yard line. And Napier wants to throw up top, looking for Bear, who makes a nice catch and goes out of bounds. First down, Furman, and that was well done.
Outstanding. I mean, Bryant extends, gets his hands up. Another high pass, though. But Napier, has gotten some time. Now he just needs to do this, complete the passes.
And look at Bear going up behind him, up in the air. That's a big-time catch.
Big-time catch. And this is what I thought I was going to see this afternoon. Reinhart, one of the better receivers in the Southern Conference, taking advantage of the secondary of the Eagles.
Well, they only made one catch in the first half when nothing was going right for Furman. He's already made a couple here in the second half, and the Paladins in Eagle territory. That's the 48. Napier, play action. Has time, and now changes his mind. On the run, Napier picks up maybe 6, but goes down hard.
But Burchett, 51, James Burchett brings him down. Napier will learn. Go down. Don't take hits. He's very valuable to this football team. Now I realize the score is out of hand. But at the same time, he's got to play, try to lead the troops back. But then, too, he's got to go down and don't take any hits because they still have some more football left.
Well, the 6-yard pickup by Napier gives Furman a 2nd and 4 at the 42-yard line of Georgia Southern under the 2-minute mark of the third quarter. Napier under center and wants to throw again. Looking for Bear Reinhart, who again goes up and makes an outstanding catch.
Acrobatic. What adjustment. This guy here is a football player. He's tough. He's physical. And you can see here, he's relentless. I mean, this isn't an easy pass to catch, but he catches it. Total concentration. I mean, he turns pretty much all the way around, or at least a 180.
That's just a great catch, great concentration, as you mentioned, and a pair of good hands. First and 10 Furman now knocking at the door a bit at the 28-yard line of Georgia Southern. But this does not work. Brigham brought down for a loss. But Billy Napier, after shaking off the substandard first half, he's been moving up the Furman record books. You can see that Napier is closing in on Bobby Lamb to move into what would become third place on the all-time Furman list of passing yardage. Napier has already leapfrogged Clyde Huell to move into fourth place today, and he's moving up the all-time touchdown list as well. Now currently tied for fifth Furman all-time. Bobby Lamb leads that far and away. Napier and company have 24 in their careers. Lamb threw 41. Napier throwing here, and Willis Sutterth makes his first catch of the day. The tight end hit immediately and dropped shy of the first down.
Well, Napier, he's had a good career. I mean, last year they had a veteran team. He was a newcomer on the block, and nobody knew what he could do. And you go back to last season, what does he do? He lead his team to the championship game. And now they're in a good position now to possibly get back there, but they'll have to win the rest of their games to see if they can get that far.
Third and two from just outside Georgia Southern's 20-yard line. Napier in the shotgun, and a lot of movement on the line, and the flags go down.
Well, defensively, they moved first, but then right tackle Stephen Kane, 74, he followed that movement.
And he's the big pro prospect, 6'5", 310. He's drawn all sorts of attention from NFL scouts, but nobody would like to see that.
No, he just flinched. He saw the movement, and he bit on it.
Dead ball. It's offside. Defense, that's 5 yards. It'll be a first down.
But he had good reason to bite.
Oh, yes. Hey, those guys, they call out numbers, too. Although they move on that play, defensive guys, they'll get over there and they think they're quarterbacks, and they'll start calling out a cadence or blue, yellow, red, whatever they sort of think they picked up on, they'll go out there and yell it out.
Well, Furman, with its deepest penetration of the game, just outside the 15-yard line. First and 10, closing seconds of the third quarter. And Brigham up the gut, gets to about the 10. You know, the Georgia Southern offense overshadows what's been a solid defense all season long. Opponents have only made it inside the 20 19 times this season. So this is just the 20th time it's happened to Georgia Southern this year. And we'll have to see what happens when we come back. It's been a rather quiet third quarter compared to what happened in the second, but it's been back and forth. Furman able to get on the board as Bobby Lamb and company came out of the locker room trailing 35-0. Isaac West, the touchdown catch, but Southern answered when Mark Myers went 71 yards. We go to the fourth in a moment. Welcome back to Greenville, South Carolina, and let's take a look at our Carolina Ford dealers game summary. It's been a one-sided affair. Georgia Southern, 35-0 to the locker room. Chaz Williams, 3 rushing touchdowns, 19 now on the season. That's a new Georgia Southern record for quarterbacks in a single season. Z. Walden has not only run for a touchdown, but he caught one as well. And, of course, Mark Myers, another slot back, went 71 yards for a score. Furman scored the first touchdown of the second half, but it was answered immediately by that Myers touchdown. Furman knocking at the door here at the 10-yard line. Second down. And Napier to the end zone. Touchdown. Corey Tant, the fullback, out of the backfield. So Furman inches a little closer.
That was the old Fulham play. Send the fullback inside. Make the linebacker walk up and bite. The fullback, he slipped behind the linebacker. See 56, Joe Scott? He took 26, and there's a fullback for 6.
That play works to perfection. But for Furman, it's really about saving face at this point and get something positive out of this game.
Well, right now, you just stick with your offense. Stick with your game plan. There's no need to come out and throw the ball all over the field, and I think that's why we haven't seen that, because they just want to get something positive out of this game, because you look at the scoreboard and you can see they're not very happy so far about the outcome.
Well, Furman cuts the deficit to 42-14, and again, It's a little lengthy with less than a full quarter to play, but again, as you mentioned, Ethan, just trying to get something positive, run your offense, and you're right. That's exactly what Furman has done. Well, not going crazy.
No, and they still have a few more games, and this play right here could be a play that they use in one of their games. They still have a big game against Wofford. I mean, Wofford's still in the thick of this thing. So you look at this offense, you just want to go out and say, okay, we haven't played very well. Let's go out and try to do some of the things that we may have done or we think we have done very well, and let's try to apply that. And I think that's why they have the score. But as you stated, Paul, this deficit is pretty deep, and it's strong, and we are already into the fourth quarter.
And again, the conference may be slipping away from Furman, but the playoffs are still out there. And again, with four teams ranked in the top 15, it's hard to imagine the NCAA will take four from one conference to fill their field of 16. So Furman is clearly right in the middle of the hunt for that. And in reality, that is just as important as anything else. Get to the postseason, and then you've got a chance.
Well, that was proven last year. You look at this Furman team going down to Statesboro, knocking off Georgia Southern. I think they had won 39 straight games. That's a heck of a streak.
And Furman ready to kick things off to Georgia Southern. Danny Marshall lets it go. And the always dangerous Anthony Williams looking for running room. Getting a block across the 25. And a nice tackle made there, a touchdown saving tackle. And Georgia Southern will start in decent field position. We are in Paladin Stadium in Greenville, South Carolina, on the campus of Furman University. Paul Crane, Ethan Horton, Jim Noble, and our fine Fox Sports Net crew in what we thought was going to be a closely fought battle with conference title ramifications. It has been all Georgia Southern. The finest ground attack in the nation at any level has lived up to every bit of that today.
Well, also the turnovers hurt Furman, and they haven't regained anything. And you look at Chaz Williams, he also has hurt this football team, and he got everyone else involved, Paul. And as you mentioned, we expected something more out of this defense against this offense, because some of these players have seen it before. We have not seen that. We've seen some strange things today.
Chaz Williams, enough for a first down, and we go down to Jim Noble.
Guys, some of the success that Chaz Williams is having tonight really has to go to his two quarterback coaches. You're looking at Greg Hill, the former Georgia Southern standout, who's actually the wide receivers coach. And, of course, the real quarterback coach upstairs is Mitch Ware. But what Greg Hill does for Chaz Williams is he can coach him on the intangibles, all the pressure that comes with being quarterback in Statesboro for Georgia Southern. Of course, Mitch Ware upstairs works on the techniques, the fundamentals of the quarterback position. With two quarterback coaches like that, it's no wonder Chaz is having the game of his life.
In what was to be the biggest game of his season, you're right, Jim. And Chaz Williams wearing number 10, which Greg Hill wore right when he played at Georgia Southern, and he's certainly living up to that number in a fine fashion.
Well, he idolizes. You're talking about Greg Hill. What about J.R. Revere, Tracy Ham? I mean, these guys have won championships, and he wants to follow those guys.
Jermaine Austin, first man through, picks up a couple, and you saw the numbers a moment ago under Chaz Williams. He's now at 99 yards rushing. Next time he leans forward, he'll go over 100 for the seventh consecutive game.
That's very impressive. It's impressive for two reasons. One, because this kid is a quarterback, and two is because this young quarterback has been given the key to the range. Now just drive the car, you know.
Well, he's driving very well and extending his school record the next time he carries the football. Chaz Williams under center, a 3-yard pickup, and there you go. Williams over the 45 and over the 100-yard mark for the seventh consecutive game. And Williams, who struggled in this position when he was handed the keys earlier in the year, has certainly grabbed him, and he's turned into what looks like a professional driver.
Well, he almost fumbled that one. I mean, the ball popped out. He caught it in midair, and that's why he struggled early, Paul. It's because of the fumbles. And I think it was because of getting acclimated to the situation, because J.R. Revere, he had been there for so long, and he had become the guy. So Williams really didn't have the experience or the reps in practice and really in games to feel comfortable.
Well, Williams is very comfortable now. Kevin Davis, the man in motion. And Williams lets it go. Another first down for Georgia Southern. As Jermaine Austin comes from his fullback spot, Paul Billingsley runs him out of bounds, but a little too little, too late.
Well, Furman talked about being basic. Georgia Southern, very basic. They run the same plays. They just have a different variety of sometimes the alignment of certain players and where they come from to receive that option. I mean, they get the ball to everybody. Just line up, we'll get it to you.
Another first down. Now in Paladin territory. Williams on the keeper again. Picks up perhaps 4, maybe 5 inches toward the 40-yard line. And Georgia Southern just working the clock, grinding it out, ready to shorten this game and get back on the bus.
Well, this is their offense, and they don't want to get anyone injured because you touched on it. You're looking at two teams that are really, yes, they are playing for the Southern Conference Championship, but they also, they're playing for the 1AA playoffs. And I think Furman will get there. I also feel like Georgia Southern will get there. Definitely Furman will have to win their games. But going back to Georgia Southern for a second, Paul, they are just wanting to stay in gear to get ready for another run.
A 5-yard pickup puts the Eagles in 2nd and 5. And Williams gives it to Austin, who gets 1, maybe 2. Now, having the dominating lead coming into the fourth quarter, Ethan, is a little different than some of their other games, but Georgia Southern, regardless of what the lead is dominating once it gets to the fourth quarter with a lead. 63 times in a row, Georgia Southern has won the game when they were leading at the end of the third quarter.
Well, this is their football game. They're not going to hurry. Just take your time. You have the ball, you have the lead, and you just want to perfect everything you're doing, but also you want some of the younger guys to play.
3rd and 3. Davis, the man in motion. Williams calls his own number and gets another first down across the 35 to about the 34 of Furman.
See, with the exception of Williams and Austin, they've changed their wide receivers, their slot backs. I mean, they're trying to get these guys ready for, I'm going to say, a few more games, if not that, next year. This is a very young team on offense. And they want to give their guys some experience. You look at Mark Myers, he's a senior. Zee Walden, a senior. But for the most part, this offense is very, very young. And so they want to really give their young guys a chance and really evaluate them in game time situations. And also they practice, so let them play.
And Jermaine Austin, a redshirt freshman, has done such a great job of filling that position that had been occupied 4 years by Adrian Peterson. Talk about pressure. We talked about the pressure on Mike Seawalk. Certainly pressure to fill those kind of shoes. Williams on the keeper again, grinding out positive yardage, positive as the clock continues to tick down, and Georgia Southern continues to move.
Paul, when you win 6 championships, and you're looking at maybe 6 straight Southern Conference championships, pressure comes. Because people become, they become used to, they're accustomed to winning. And I think that's what they have down in Statesboro, Georgia. That's why they don't care about the Southern Conference. They worry about the championships, the national championships, and you see there, 6.
Well, Mike Seawalk, a big guy in a small town, there's nowhere for him to hide. Everyone knows who he is when he walks the streets of Statesboro, Georgia, and everyone has the highest of expectations because, as we've mentioned, all that's come before. And Georgia Southern looking every bit like a champion today. Austin off the pitch, fights for some tough yardage, shy of the first down, but continues to move.
But having said that also, look at the games or the big games that the head coach was involved in as an assistant coach. I mean, Seawalk, he's been around this program for a long time, and actually he was the offensive coordinator before taking the job. Been around Paul Johnson for a long time, so he's experienced in these type of settings, these situations, and his team has definitely played for him today.
It'll be 3rd and 1 for Georgia Southern at the Furman 26-yard line as the Eagles continue to grind it out. Just over 9 minutes to play in the fourth quarter in a game that Georgia Southern has dominated from the outset, scoring on its first possession and never looking back. Williams with the pitch. T.J. Anderson inside the 20 has the first down before being wrestled out of bounds. The clock will stop, but the chains get moved.
And you look at T.J. Anderson, another young guy, sophomore. He averages over 18 yards per carry. So, I mean, you look at this football team and you scratch your head and you wonder why have they been so successful over the years. It's because they go out and find good talent, they keep them around, and they develop them, and when it's their turn, they go out there and make it happen.
You look at this team, Ethan, and they put up the kind of numbers that are usually only seen in video games.
Right. Mind-boggling.
Inside the 20. First and 10 for Georgia Southern. Chaz Williams again runs his own number. Williams inside the 10 to the 5. Touchdown, Chaz Williams, his fourth of the game.
I think we've seen the last of Chaz Williams. I would take him out of the football game.
Have a seat, young man, and thank you very much. But we'll see. And a flag on the play. Looks like this one is coming back. So erase touchdown number 4. And in a one-sided game, Mike Seawalk has something to be unhappy about.
Well, I mean...
they can go coach him up now.
Really, because so far everything he's called, it has worked on both sides. I mean, they have the number one rated defense, the number one rated offense.
That time it was holding, and perhaps that's why such a big hole had been created, but the way these two teams have played today, I doubt it.
No, I don't think it matters. I mean, they haven't stopped this offense all day, and granted, it's first and 20. I think they'll get 20 yards. They haven't been stopped today, so my hat's to the offense.
Well, first and 20 for Georgia Southern inside the Furman 30-yard line. Chaz Williams back to work with the shovel pass and a whole lot of nothing there. T.J. Anderson taking that pitch slash shovel.
Well, Sperling, he really defended the play. I mean, you got to give Furman some credit as well from a standpoint of they had 2 weeks to prepare. They haven't come out and played well. And I really think that extra week has affected this football team because this isn't the same football team we've come to know. I mean, they don't even look like a football team today. I mean, you know they're well coached. You know they're well prepared. But today, they've just been manhandled by Georgia Southern.
Surprising, considering everything that's been at stake. And Williams wants to throw from the pocket. Nobody home. It's incomplete. And that's really the first time it failed completely.
Yes. And you go back to Furman. Furman has been one of the better teams to play Georgia Southern because I think when a lot of teams play Georgia Southern, they're intimidated. And you look at this streak, that's about to end, the 15-game home win streak versus the SoCon teams. Now, Furman, for some reason, they haven't matched the intensity when before they have always done that. And for some reason, you know, it just hasn't been matched today.
The winning streak, 15 in a row at home. The last time Furman lost to a Southern Conference team, you saw it was to Georgia Southern in November of 1998. Third and 20. Georgia Southern inside the 30. Williams drops back and then wants to run. But this one is well defended. Purple shirts everywhere, and down goes Chaz, the leader, Cedric Ritter, on the tackle.
Well, he's their leading tackler, and we haven't really called his name, Cedric Ritter, a lot today because he's been chasing all day. He's been one of those linebackers that has been cut between the quarterback and the running back and the fullback and everybody else they've thrown out there, and that's why Ritter hasn't been called.
As we approach the halfway mark of the fourth quarter, Georgia Southern dominating performance, 42-14. It's a fourth down play, and why punt?
There's no need.
No need at all. See what's in the fourth and 22 playbook. Fullback straight ahead, well, and they'll turn it over on downs.
I don't know if that was the play, the 22 yard. That was probably the safe play. Let's just give it to him and get them off the field, probably.
Well, as we mentioned at the top of the broadcast, this one of the top rivalries in college football, certainly in the Southern Conference. Georgia Southern has brought its A game and a physical nature along with it. We'll be back. Georgia Southern 42, Furman 14.
Seven 7 minutes and 16 seconds away from their sixth straight Southern Conference championship. Georgia Southern Furman 42-14. Folks, it's become obvious over the years that you don't have to play in one of the so-called super conferences across the nation to get a look from the NFL. Need some proof? Here it is. NCAA standouts. How about Jerry Rice, the greatest receiver in NFL history with the 49ers, now the Raiders. He, of course, started out at Mississippi Valley State. Terrell Owens filled Rice's shoes nicely in San Fran, former star at Chattanooga. The former Delaware Blue Hen, still going strong, Rich Gannon with the Vikings, the Chiefs, now in the midst of an all-pro career with the Oakland Raiders. And, of course, Steve McNair started Alcorn State before moving on to the Tennessee Titans. So, folks, if you are good enough, if you play in a 1AA school, if you play in a Southern Conference school, does not matter. The National Football League will find you.
You could be playing, Jim, on a small island in the South Pacific. If you could play, the NFL will find you. But how about Dexter Coakley, who had such a great career at Appalachian State and is doing the same with the Cowboys? The list is very long, and the Southern Conference has much to be proud of. Billy Napier gives it to Rembert. Lamar Rembert can't find any room, and he's lucky to get back to the line of scrimmage.
Well, I want to go back to what you were just talking about, 17 former players active from the SoCon. If you can play football, they haven't, with the exception of Cincinnati, they have enough employees in their scouting department that they can go out and find them. The reason I mention Cincinnati because, you know, they don't like to pay people to go out and scout and look, so they have very few.
It's all right. We're just talking about the NFL. Oh, they're still in it. Second and 9. Napier wants to throw over the middle, complete. Willis Sutter, the tight end, is open, and Napier connects.
Big target. I mean, 6'3", 244, you get that big body going down the field, it's easy to find 84 in blue. And just a little play down the middle where most tight ends roam. Wide open. Georgia Southern then looking into the backfield of play action, and that's where the linebackers weren't there.
And that is what Bobby Lamb was hoping his team would be able to do, work the play action, find somebody over the middle, just didn't want to do it in an enormous hole. Napier with time, and now out of the pocket, gets over the 40, picks up a few yards, but he'll be well shy of the first down.
Well, he hasn't been given a lot of opportunities because defensively, you're looking at the best defense in the Southern Conference. On the ground, they're number one. Through the air, they're number two. 8 interceptions. So they don't really give up an awful lot, and they haven't given up an awful lot today. So defensively, they've beaten Billy Napier.
Second and 5. Napier gives it to Rembert. Rembert straight ahead. Gets to about the 35-yard line. He'll be a couple of yards shy of the third down. And again, Ethan, as you had mentioned, Furman just continuing to run its offense.
Well, they must do that. And you can see here, the Furman players, they're dejected, disappointed, and rightfully so. But you'll buckle it up tomorrow, Monday, and get ready to go again because the season isn't over. And that's what the coaches will have to guard against. Say, hey, yes, we did lose a big game, but we still have a few more to go, and maybe we have our destiny in our own hands.
Certainly the Southern Conference will have more than the automatic bid to the 1AA playoffs, and Furman certainly right in the hunt to have one of those at-large bids, regardless of what happens today. Lamar Rembert again inside, but nothing home. Well shy of the first down, a little extracurricular activity as the flags fly.
Well, they're still trying to get after it. And they should.
We're inside the 5-minute mark. Face mask the call. So it'll be a first down for Furman. And I think at this point, the Paladins will take whatever they can get. Coming up tonight on Fox Sports Net, an outstanding college football game from the Pac-10 as the surprising Cal Bears go to Arizona State. The Sun Devils certainly right in the hunt for a trip to the Rose Bowl. At 7 Eastern, some of you will see the Penguins and Carolina Hurricanes. And coming up at 9 Eastern, the Memphis Grizzlies and Denver Nuggets. Memphis with its best chance yet to get perhaps its first win of the year. Then, of course, the NFL show later. Check your local Fox Sports Net affiliate listings for the game in your area. First and 10 for Furman at the 31-yard line. Billy Napier looking and Dale Reinhart's open, makes another nice catch, but he pays for it out of bounds.
Well, I'll tell you what, you're talking about Reinhart paying for it. Also, Napier, he paid for it as well. Number 90, Victor Cabral, clobbered it.
But a flag on the play. This one is coming back. But how about this? All for nothing, Ethan.
Well, you saw that hit. He got drilled, and he gets drilled. I don't think he had control of this football. I mean, he has it right there. See, he hasn't really tucked it away. Now he gets hit.
Well, he's got it's on his hip in control.
But the ball hit what? The ground? Ground can't knock it out. That's just like when you get a fumble. Fumble, ground can't knock it out. But this case, he never controlled the ball in my play.
Well, it's called incomplete. Second and 10 now from just outside the 30-yard line. Napier again, up top. And a nice stretching catch. Isaac West.
The same guy, Aaron Whitaker. Now, they picked on Aaron Whitaker all afternoon. They've had some success. And, I mean, we're into the fourth quarter. Why didn't we see them pick on him earlier in the game? Because, obviously, this is a guy they like. They like this matchup, and they have gone after. And they, like I said, West has really beaten him deep. But we haven't seen it with any consistency.
And that's just an outstanding catch. Isaac West running to the football. We talked about him having such great speed. He's also got the hands to go with it.
Well, he's an outstanding receiver.
First and goal for Furman. Nobody home as Brigham goes up the middle. And Billy Napier has moved a little further up the Furman career list. He just leapfrogged his head coach, moving ahead of Bobby Lamb on Furman's all-time career passing list, over 4,200 yards now, and into third place all-time at Furman.
Outstanding accomplishments. I mean, he's going to add to those totals, but I guarantee you he would rather have the lead in his game opposed to those totals.
No question about that. At this point, too little, too late, approaching the three-and-a-half-minute mark of the fourth quarter. Napier to the end zone for Isaac West. Touchdown, Furman.
Well, this time they work on 21, Deion Stokes. I mean, West, he's made some plays. He hasn't been given a lot of opportunities, but when he has been given the opportunity, you know, he's come up with some nice plays for this offense.
And again, Furman trying to save some face and doing a pretty good job of it as they stuck to their original game plan. It may be too little too late, but it is coming to fruition.
Yeah.
So perhaps better late than never. Furman trying to close the gap a little more, and they do. 42-21, under 3.5 minutes to play, but Furman giving us a couple of highlights. Napier and Isaac West. Furman pulls within 3 touchdowns. Welcome back to Greenville, South Carolina. Georgia Southern's lead over Furman cut to 42-21. It's back and better than ever. The undisputed champion of pregame shows returns as JB, Terry, Howie, and Jimmy kick off week number 10 of NFL action. This week, we talked to members of the Steelers' defense on how they plan on stopping Michael Vick and the Falcons. Fox NFL Sunday returns this week only on Fox, followed by the Steelers battling the Falcons.
That should be a pretty good football game.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Michael Vick, he's become a human highlight machine.
He's playing well.
And certainly a challenge for the Steelers, who have been pretty good on defense this year.
Tommy Maddox has really taken that team by the reins.
Talk about having your career resurrected. His has been exhumed.
You're right.
Well, Furman to kick to Ant Williams. Fourth in the nation in kick returns. Hasn't really had the opportunity to do much today. And look at that. Ball's inside the 30, and it's almost fair caught. Just downed right there.
Well, Trey Hunter, 14, the backup quarterback. He's in on the hands team. So Georgia Southern, they were just looking for some type of onside kick, although they received a pooch kick. Good hands by the quarterback.
Well, with 3:21 to go in the game and the score 42-21, our Pepsi player of the game is Georgia Southern quarterback Chaz Williams. All he's done is run for 110 yards and 3 touchdowns.
Well, it's not a big surprise. Chaz Williams is a player of the game because coming into this football game, he was the key for Georgia Southern to win this football game. He has been as good as advertised. He's made the good decisions. He's made the tough runs. He's put his team in great position on offense because he's put them in good plays at the right time.
Williams on the keeper gets a whole lot of nothing there. And actually, it's the backup quarterback is in, Trey Hunter, with his opportunity. And Williams leading an offense to more than 400 yards on the ground, 492 before that play of total offense. It's just been an incredible machine. And Trey Hunter now getting his opportunity to get his uniform dirty.
Well, he should. And these two quarterbacks support each other. I think that's the best thing about competition is when you have guys competing for the same position, but there's no animosity or jealousy. Now, realize winning pretty much cures all. And in this case, winning is everything.
Well, Trey Hunter with his opportunity. And he gives it to the first man through, which is Brandon Mays, redshirt freshman from Arden, North Carolina. Cedric Ritter on the tackle, but we have an injured Paladin player down. A reminder to keep it here on Fox Sports Net. Depending on where you are, you've got a plethora of good games. Coming up at the bottom of the hour, Cal and Arizona State. It's a big one in the Pac-10 with Rose Bowl ramifications perhaps for the Sun Devils. The Penguins and Carolina Hurricanes do battle at 7 Eastern, and the Memphis Grizzlies continue to search for their first win of the year. They have certainly shown a lot of spunk this year, despite the fact they're the only team in the NBA without a win. Sidney Lowe's guys have certainly looked good. They had a solid performance in Sacramento last night, and they're in a place that they just might get that first win. Denver has been struggling. Of course, the NFL show will follow at 10:15 Eastern. Check your local Fox Sports Net affiliate listing for the game in your area.
I think they'll get that win, but also Jerry West, he will turn that program around if he stays there long enough.
Well, he certainly seems to be committed there, and despite the slow start, there have been a lot of good signs in Memphis, so stick around for that again at 9 Eastern in some of our Fox Sports Net areas. Jazz Williams and Georgia Southern have dominated this game from the opening possession when they drove the length of the field and punched it in for a touchdown that gave them a lead they would never look back from. And then 28 points in the second quarter blew this baby open.
And also our injured player, number 90, Michael Morant. He's up on his feet. Looks like he's going to walk off under his own power, which is a good sign.
Well, let's go down to Jim Noble.
Well, guys, Furman was hoping to take advantage of this big game atmosphere by entertaining about 100 high school recruits here at the ball game. Now, you might wonder what recruits do when they're here at the game. Well, they show up very early in the morning. They talk to the coaches, the players, get to watch a little game film, and then they get to watch the game from the field. Also, these players are entertained by Furman's Finest, a group of young ladies who act as chaperones for the recruits. And that factor can't be underestimated, guys, because the Furman's Finest certainly live up to their name. And I mean that in the nicest possible way.
Of course you do, Jim. Certainly Furman's Finest has not been on the gridiron for much of today.
We haven't seen it.
No, we haven't. And it's garbage time for Georgia Southern. Trey Hunter getting his opportunity, calls his own number. Hunter, nothing home, and it'll be fourth down.
Oh, it's third and 8. I didn't expect him to come out and throw the football, and now it's just a matter of running out the clock.
Andrew Knight making the tackle and making the most of his opportunity to play. And there's not much clock left. Under the 1:45 mark, and Georgia Southern will punt, and we'll see what we get from Furman's side.
Well, I think they should set up the block. I mean, what do they have to lose? Because at this state of the ball game, work on your special teams. You've pretty much stuck with the game plan offensively. Defensively, you had problems stopping Georgia Southern. Now work on your special teams. I mean, give the next opponents something to think about.
And for Furman in particular, as you've mentioned, Ethan, they've got to save something from this for when they move through the rest of the season. They've got two more conference games still to play, and then what they hope will be an at-large bid to the playoffs. And if they're going to go deep into the playoffs as they did a year ago, they've got to come out of this with something positive so they know they can get it done, whether or not they meet Georgia Southern again down the road.
Well, I think the positive coming out of this game will be this. We thought we had a pretty good football team, and they possibly still do. They will now become motivated, I think. Not to say they were not today, but I think it's going to add a little extra to them this week in practice and the following week, because now the stakes only get higher.
Well, it certainly puts them in a new position, a different kind of challenge. They did such a nice job of crawling out of that disaster that happened to them at Appalachian, but this, an incredible disappointment. And yes, the heat was brought, but Scott Shelton able to get it away. Reinhart with his first return opportunity gets it to the 45, but that'll be it. We've got the final minute and a half still to play. Furman in the deepest of holes, but they get one last chance in a moment. Closing moments of what we thought was going to be an intense battle for Southern Conference supremacy. Instead, it's been a clinic by the Georgia Southern Eagles.
I don't know if it's been a clinic or has it been just a total thrashing. You know, hey, you guys think you're with the big time? We're going to show you what big time football is all about. And they've come out and just done everything well.
Well, this is called Paladin Stadium, but today it's been the woodshed. And Bo Moore getting his opportunity in for Billy Napier at quarterback. And Moore is going to throw the football and complete the football. That's James Thomas, who's played much of the day. He's been out there on several possessions. He finally gets his first chance to make a catch.
Well, this is just change-up. Bo Moore, he practices. This is the reward for the guys that practice during the week. Although this is a blowout, let him play a little bit too.
So the first down inside Georgia Southern's 30. Bo Moore, the sophomore from Madison, Georgia. And now he's got to find something on the run. Moore takes a hit inside the 25. And he picks up some positive yardage.
Well, David Young, he's been the quarterback hunter today. I mean, he's taken out Billy Napier. He's come back now. He's taken out Bo Moore. I mean, 18's been all over the field.
Well, 18 is an All-American. We mentioned how he's a four-year starter. Not only is he one of the best guys out there in the secondary, but he's one of the hardest hitters. And we've certainly seen him deliver some blows today.
Well, also, he's one of the seniors that Coach Seawalk was talking about, taking over the football team. Because going back to earlier in the season, a lot of these guys, they didn't know where they stood. They didn't know what their roles were. David Moore, Z. Walden, Mark Myers, Freddie Pesceda. I mean, these guys took over the football team. They had to put their arms around some of these younger guys. You look at Young, he took control of the secondary and say, hey, look, this is the way it's done at Georgia Southern. Yes, we have started out at 1-2. But now all of a sudden, you look where they are. They look really prime for the next level. But Young, he's still playing hard, even with the big lead. And when you have shots like these on the quarterback, you take them.
And again, Georgia Southern getting off to such a slow start for them. 1-2, having lost their star quarterback, having lost their all-world fullback. They've done a nice job of getting this team back together. And you're right, Ethan. Senior leadership is irreplaceable. And Bo Moore, now 2-for-2 throwing. But, of course, statistics don't ever really tell the truth.
No, well, his 2-for-2, when you look at the box scores tomorrow, they'll see, okay, what did Billy do? What was the score? He got a little time.
Yeah, it's just a little different situation. Under the one-minute mark here in the fourth quarter, Georgia Southern ready to wrap up what will be, at the very least, a tie for the conference title and what will be their sixth consecutive Southern Conference title.
But they've come in here and played like a championship team. I mean, their demeanor on the field was of a champion. And it's very hard sometimes. You try to get all three phases to play well. I realize on offense they turn the ball over twice, and that's something they've done just about every week. But I guess the point I'm trying to make is on every phase of this football team, they excel. I mean, special teams, they played well. Look at the turnovers. I guess you're going to say when Brian Bratton goes to sleep tonight, kick returner, he's seeing white jerseys saying, where are they coming from?
It's a nightmare for him. And we saw Mike Seawalk there. Since Mike Seawalk arrived as the team's offensive coordinator, the Eagles have broken or tied 452 team and individual records coming into the day. And we know Chaz Williams has added his name to that, so it's at least 453. Bowmore runs for the first down as the clock continues to tick, even though it stops to move the chains. And Mike Seawalk has helped lead this team to a sixth consecutive Southern Conference championship. That's something, Ethan, in the long history of this great conference, has never been done before.
All I can do is shake my head.
Bowmore wants to throw, and it's knocked down as he throws into coverage. But still, as you mentioned, Georgia Southern playing hard, getting those big arms up there. They're not going to give anything away.
Well, they don't want to be scored on any more than they already have. They want to make this loss as embarrassing as they possibly can.
Those six consecutive Southern Conference championships are second in length in 1AA only to Northern Iowa, who won seven conference championships. And certainly the way these young players have played for Georgia Southern, they'll certainly have the opportunity to attack that next year. But not to put the cart in front of the horse, Bowmore, his pass overthrown, and we're down inside the 40-second mark of the fourth quarter.
Well, how can you deny success? I mean, you can't help but say, well, maybe they'll get there next year or the next couple of years. I mean, each decade, you know, they put together a string of wins, a lot of good players, a lot of good teams. And when you have success, you know, you can go out and get walk-ons, which they also have. They want to be a part of something good.
And Seawalk just got the now traditional dousing. But Bowmore, looking, he certainly has plenty of time. And nowhere to go. Bowmore, looking for someone to catch free, and Brian Bratton, how about that, Ethan? Hits him in the number, and he drops it.
Now, he's had a tough outing. One, I'm pretty sure he wants to forget. I don't know if he'll even watch the tape when they watch it. He maybe just cover his eyes, say, Coach, I know what happened. I don't need to see this one.
Well, we're down inside 30 seconds to go. Georgia Southern ready to start celebrating that sixth consecutive conference title. And Mike Seawalk, in his first year as head coach, after coming out of the gate with that 1-2 start, has certainly brought his team back to not only take care of the conference, but again to undoubtedly be a factor in the national championship chase. Bowmore intercepted inside the five. And that will seal the deal as Joe Scott takes care of business and pretty much puts the final nail in this coffin.
Yeah, that seals the victory. And going back to Seawalk, you know, he talked about his team playing with a lot of confidence because in the beginning, they didn't know what he was all about as a head coach. The players had known him as a position coach, the offensive coordinator, but they didn't know what they were getting. So it was a mystery on both sides because he knew he was getting a team that had been coached by a different coach. But now I think they've come together.
Well, Georgia Southern ready to run out the rest of this clock as Trey Hunter takes a knee, and that will pretty much do it. The clock will come down, and Georgia Southern's Eagles are soaring indeed. A dominating performance from start to finish and on both sides of the ball. The offense will certainly get a lot of attention for the incredible yardage it racked up. 493 yards of total offense, 409 on the ground, but the defense certainly was every bit as impressive as the offense today.
Well, they lived up to their billing, number one in the conference. I mean, they shut down the passing lanes. They shut down the rushing lanes. I mean, they were very prepared on defense, and it showed.
All right, let's go down to Jim Noble.
All right, guys, thank you. Freddie Piscata, we were ready for a nail biter. We were ready for a close game. Obviously, you guys and your defense had other ideas today.
Yeah, I mean, we were ready for a nail biter also. No, we came out here, and we were expecting a fight, all the way to the last second. But luckily, we got after him in the first half, racked some points up on the board and never let him get back in the game.
You're a senior, a Southern Conference ring. Every year you played at Georgia Southern, what does that mean?
That's the best feeling in the world. I mean, people go to college wishing to get one. I got four of them. So, I mean, it's the best feeling in the world. I'm going to go celebrate tonight and have fun with the guys.
Finally, one game left, and then, of course, there are bigger fish to fry. How do you think this sets you guys up for your usual run?
I mean, this is perfect. Exactly what we wanted. Come out here, win the conference, and get momentum going into the playoffs. And we're going to go out there, give it our best shot, and see if we can't go back to Chattanooga this year.
Freddie, congratulations.
Thank you
very much. Let's go back upstairs to Paul and Ethan.
Well, Freddie Piscata, a great performance. And the Georgia Southern Eagles, a great performance as well. It's been dominating from start to finish. We'll be back to wrap things up in a moment. Rivalries in 1AA football lived up to its reputation on one side of the ball as Georgia Southern delivered a number of blows offensively and defensively on Furman. So for Ethan Horton and Jim Noble and our fine Fox Sportsnet crew, this is Paul Crane saying so long from Paladin Stadium in Greenville, South Carolina, where the final score is 42-21. Start your NFL weekend the night before kickoff with the NFL Show presented by the U.S. Postal Service. Tonight, after college football, coming up on Fox Sportsnet, Cal and Arizona State, Penguins, Hurricanes, or Grizzlies, Nuggets, check your local listings. You've been watching college football on Fox Sportsnet, your regional home for Southern Conference football.